The Roddy Piler here tonight, Dave.
Yeah, two of them, yep.
Yeah.
Engaged in the,
That's it. Not official.
Scott, what, we use the gavel like once in 15 years?
I think he's on the finance committee, too.
I think there was a guy from the other side of the river, and he started yelling at us. Remember that?
Right.
I've never seen it used.
We don't do that on this side of the river.
But his response was priceless.
I know it was. All right. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is regularly scheduled meeting of Sunderland Board of Selectmen. I'd like to call us to order at 6:40. The glasses are on. We're budget time, so now that we have to magnify the numbers so we see them a little bit better. I know last week we started with the announcement of the passing of Tom Herrick, and just like a quick note on a personal level, resident of Sunderland from the 1960s, Carolyn Connolly passed away. She lived on Silver Lane since 1960, so probably 50 plus years. Family's lived here, still lives there. And it was just one of those good residents. Her husband came and had a nice house and worked hard and kept it up. And son moved next door and raised his family and chased me out of their yard a couple times. And guy Scott Smith lived up the street from the Conleys, and he got chased out a couple times also. So I just, they're a nice family, and I just wanted to mention her passing, 98 years old. And I'm sure the family's going to miss her very much. Tonight, we are going to start off with Fire Chief Steve Benjamin. He put together a package to discuss the fire truck purchase. So, Stephen,
thank you.
The floor is yours.
Thank you. I'll just start off by saying, those of you that have business later on, don't worry, it's only about 20 slides. So you see PowerPoint and you've grown.
Yeah.
Not bad. But what I wanted to do is come back and address the board after the first meeting that we had. There were still a lot of questions and a little bit more research that I was asked to do and then come back. And I figured I'd put that together in something that was able to show a couple of photos and also put a little bit of description to what I had been talking about earlier. So for those of you that aren't aware, we're talking about the replacement of our 1988 fire truck, our engine 2. And what we've got is an older truck, both in age but also in technology. And the much better.
Thanks.
Thank you, Ben.
Thank you, Ben. The lowdown on this truck is it served us well. However, going from the bottom up, we've got some pump issues, got a leak. It seats 4 firefighters, 2 of them outside facing backwards, which is not uncommon for trucks of that vintage, but it's not an orientation you're able to purchase and use today. It doesn't meet DOT or National Fire Protection Association standards. Also, several ongoing electrical issues, and it has had electrical issues since the very beginning. A lot of these 1980s, 1990s custom cabs, meaning they're not trucks like you'd see pulling a trailer down the road, but custom built for the fire service, they're very common, and electrical problems are also very common. Also, HVAC issues. They fog up, you put 4 firefighters in it, it's like a terrarium, almost. A little bit more on the truck, a few different angles. You can see the layout is like a lot of fire trucks. Very narrow cab in the front, as shown by the center picture. Also, you can see, and I'll just come over, I won't use the laser. Blind or person by accident. But here you can see the open cab, and on the back, you can see it also. There's a safety bar, there's a seat right there, and the firefighter comes right out and steps on the running board. And it's fine, there's nothing that says we can't use it now, but as we start to go through new criteria for trucks, we see that's not allowed anymore. And that also plays into another item that I'll talk about in a second here. with fire trucks, there's always a little bit of a conversation, do we replace it or do we refurbish it? And refurbishing fire trucks is a pretty big business because they are a very expensive asset for a municipality and technology changes quite often. So if you've got a truck that's even 10 years old, you'll find yourself with what's categorized as an old truck. Can't necessarily get parts for some of the electronic systems, for the lights, things like that. You've got to go to folks that take them off of older trucks, or you've got materials that are just in storage. One of the big things to keep in mind is, like everything else in the world, there's a standard that goes along with fire trucks. And that NFPA standard 1912 oversees apparatus refurbishing. And in a nutshell, what it says is, once you put a truck in, any shop that is worth doing business with is going to work by that standard. They're not going to say they've refurbished a truck or sign a contract for that and then not follow it. That NFPA standard has both NFPA standards and DOT standards in it. And essentially what it means is, when you have a chassis that goes in, it's got to come out with all the current DOT lighting, all the current DOT braking standards, safety standards, and what have you. So all that would have to be brought up. As far as the NFPA is concerned, all of the light standards, as far as how many strobe lights, where they're going to be, would need to be in place. But also, and it plays in with this particular truck, the cab orientation. That open cab is not allowed anymore, so it would have to be enclosed. Because the overhang on the back is so short, the cab would have to be extended, and that gets into some of the rollover and crush protection that has to be in fire trucks now. So, long story short, as I was talking with one of the companies that does this on a very large scale, they've got government contracts, refurbished fire trucks overseas, and so forth, I described the truck quickly to them, and the fellow emailed me back and said, there are so many reasons why that's not going to be a cost-effective idea. Let's talk about some other options. And essentially what he said was, why don't you buy a used fire truck and refurbish it and put it into service if you really want to refurbish a fire truck. So the long and the short of it is, if you've got an aerial apparatus, a truck with a ladder on it, or a platform, those are typically very expensive. And because the upfront cost is so much more than this truck, relatively speaking, $700,000, $800,000, $900,000 or $1 million, the truck that we're entertaining is about $500,000, $500,000. To put $200,000 into a truck that's worth $500,000 instead of spending $1 million is not a bad delta. To put $200,000 into a truck and have that be half the cost of a new one is another consideration to make. The new truck that we had specified out and bid out, that process followed this timeline. And I won't go through every line, but from the spring of 2015, when we started talking to other towns and researching other trucks, all the way through really this month, we've gone through all those processes. We've talked with different fire departments, talked with different fire truck manufacturers, seen a lot of fire trucks, both at other fire stations, in some of the parades and fire truck shows that are around, and also talking with people outside of the area about best practices and what they've done. We got down to this past winter where the COG put the specifications together for us. Through that whole process, here's a list of the manufacturers that we spoke with and then the manufacturers that we met extensively with. By design, we talked with a lot of manufacturers, and some of them we had had good experiences with, some of them we had had poor experiences with, but still, things change and people change. And we came to the realization that some of our initial concepts about who we'd like to work with were correct. And we boiled that initial list down to three manufacturers that we met extensively with. And meaning extensively is, we brought them into our fire station, we sat down with them for 4 or 5 hours. They opened up their software where they spec out trucks. We went between our meeting room and the fire truck bay, and we looked at what we had, what we liked, what they had to offer, and we built three different trucks from three different manufacturers on paper, if you will. And they provided us with budgets and ideas some drawings, and certainly specifications. If you want paper and data overload, ask a fire truck guy for specifications. 200 or 300 pages is about what you get. As we went through that process, we looked at a couple of things. We wanted to have a truck similar to our Engine 3, our 15-year-old truck. That's our first line truck now. It serves us well. There's a few things that we wouldn't do again, and we rolled that into this design too. We wanted a better use of storage space, because a fire truck's a lot like a boat or an aircraft. You've only got so much space, and you try to make the most out of it. There's a lot of things you can do that way. We also wanted a larger cab, because the cab that we have now on that Engine 3 is adequate, but now that we no longer have direct control over our ambulance, we needed a space that we could use for warming in the wintertime, not just for us, but for general public, if that situation warrants it. Also, rehabilitation. If we've got a fire scene, we're now required to have a rehab area where firefighters sit down, have all their vitals taken, paramedics staff it. If that ambulance is tied up, or there's somebody more pressing that they've got to deal with, we've got to do that outside. Find some shade, find something else, and by having a slightly larger cab, we could do that in the truck, in the air conditioning, in the heat, what have you. A couple of the other things that we had early on the list, all-wheel drive, that CAFS, compressed air foam system, essentially a much more robust system to make firefighting foam than what we would normally have, just a little injector into the nozzle. Pump and roll, meaning that the truck can move and pump at the same time. Also, because they're very expensive, SCBA packs, self-contained breathing apparatus packs. We thought about specifying the truck with 6 of those packs included in the package. But with a lot of these, like the new technology to support maps and dispatch, all these fancy tool storage systems, cold weather pump packages to keep the pump from freezing in the wintertime. We ended up really with 2 things off of this wish list that we carried forward. The all-wheel drive, which was approximately a $20,000 option on the truck, surprisingly low when you look at everything. And the cold weather pump package, which just consisted of either 1 or 2, depending on the orientation, heaters in the cabinet of the truck where the pump is, and then a pan on the bottom to hold the heat in. Relatively inexpensive as well. So we, as we're putting all this together, you've got to organize it somewhere, and depending on what you do for a living, you may notice the SWOT, the strength, the weakness, opportunity type of a matrix. And it doesn't exactly fit this type of a program, but it's a good thing. It's a good analogy to use. And we did that. We picked out things we wanted, things we needed, things that were really unlikely to go forward, but we brainstormed. And we put together a specification that was put together in its final form by the Franklin Regional Council of Governments. Andrea Woods up there is the Chief Procurement Officer, and Sherry was wise enough to put me in touch with her early in the process. And what happened was the base specifications were made up of desired features from all the manufacturers. And the thing to keep in mind with trucks like this is there are 15 to 20 manufacturers of fire trucks that you could get a truck from. And all of them do some things better than others, and as a result, they really like to create their business model after those things that they do well. And they're geared up for manufacturing in certain ways. So just by essence of making choices, you narrow that list down a little bit. But what we did is we put all those things into the specs. It took about 4 months from when we got everything that we needed from all the different vendors to the time when it was done. The Council of Governments commented on and edited those specifications, both for ease of bidding, both for openness, equal bidding, and also just so it would make sense. They do quite a bit of this, and it was nice to have their input in terms of what's actually going to work and be attractive to bidders. They edited the final specifications, drafted them, and the specifications that went up onto the FERCOG website for bidding came off of their desk. So we gave them a lot of ideas, certainly had input, but they put the whole thing together for us. And That process went pretty well. Here's an example of what the specification looked like. There's a description. There were hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of these lines. It's not a construction specification, if you will, but it's just a bullet point list going through everything. And over on the right, there's two columns. Either the bidder complies or the bidder doesn't comply, and they can propose an alternate. And that was very advantageous because as you run into companies that do some things really well, and that's their mainstream, but other companies that could do something but don't really advertise it, needed to give them an opportunity to put the alternates in. And what we ended up with was a situation also where we needed to look at money. And I wanted to put this slide in because it also plays into the current state of affairs. Because I did sit down with the USDA in their Hadley office in mid-December and spoke with them about the project's potential to be funded in terms of a loan. I first asked about grants and kind of laughed and said, well, no, we don't do that for fire trucks, but I tried. And what they have is a 3% interest, give or take, loan. Funding is available this year. And that process, they had to see our specification before they would really go any further. And they give us a verbal commitment, you might say, is a fair way to put it, after going through our specification. That process took about a month. The other thing is any changes to the specification have to be evaluated by the USDA as well. And when we ended up with everything, after that discussion with the USDA, we did go up to bid. The way that it worked was HME is a manufacturer, Rosenbauer is a manufacturer. I called both of those representatives personally before the bidding started, the day before, and told them that we were going out to bid. Just wanted to make sure they saw it, if they were interested in bidding. Both of them answered in the affirmative. They were both pretty excited. The third company that we talked to, Rosenbauer, said we're probably not going to bid. It's not something that we do really well. There's bigger fish for us to catch. And despite that, seven companies downloaded bid documents off of the COG website so they could take a look at things, establish it. At the end of the day, only Rosenbauer bid. I spoke with HME after the bid, and they said that they didn't want to list out all the exclusions that they had. There were some things that we wanted that they preferred not to put on trucks, and they didn't want to submit a bid. They figured that it was either not going to be chosen or they were going to be high. And in actuality, the budget pricing, granted it's not the bid, you really can't hang your hat on it, but looking at HME's budget pricing, they were quite a bit higher. They were about $19,000 higher, and their budget didn't carry three items that were probably worth another $20,000. So on a $500,000 nut, they were about $40,000 high just in the budget. Rosenbauer, on the other hand, was about $2,000 over their budget price when they finally did put their number in. A couple options in here too. There's a slight savings if the chassis is purchased early, and there's ways that we might be able to do that. There's ways that we might not be able to do that, just in terms of how our town meeting warrant is written and what's in the best interest of the town and what we can do. There's a couple more things that we could do to bring that price down slightly. And depending on how we end up going to contract, we can either do that while the truck is being built or beforehand. So there's a lot of flexibility there to go down with simple things. By law, we can't change the truck wholesale, but we can make small changes, lights and different things that anybody could offer or take away. This is the proposed truck. It's a drawing that Rosenbauer had proposed, and it's very similar to the truck that we've got now. The differences in the front bumper, there's a hose reel. We've got hose folded up in the current truck in the front bumper. Having a hose reel will allow us to deploy that a little bit faster and also bring it back in. So for on Route 116 for a car fire, we don't have to fiddle around for 20 minutes and back things up. We can just reel the hose back in and go. It sits a little higher because of the all-wheel drive. And you'll notice the cab's a little bit bigger. I've got a comparison On top is engine three, that's our current first line truck, and on the bottom is the rendering of the new truck. There isn't a ton of difference. The layout of the hoses is slightly different. We're going with a manual ladder rack. The ladder's in the rear compartment up on top. And the truck we have now has a hydraulic arm that comes down. It takes up a lot of space. It was pretty pricey. It also takes forever and a day to come down and go up. We're just going to use a spring-loaded ladder mechanism, ideally, to bring our ladder down on that. Everything else is the same. They hold the same amount of water. The pump capacities are the same. The engine on the all-wheel drive truck's a little bit bigger, but that's just because there's some loss through the running gear of power. Some of the cost drivers for a truck like this, really any new fire truck. There's nothing that's specific to this truck that really drives the cost up. We'll get to that in another slide. But emissions, diesel engines are quite expensive and they're getting more expensive with a lot of the emissions controls that are on them. Not a bad thing, but when you're looking at a fleet and you're looking at cost, you know, it's a consideration. The electronics in vehicles are much more sophisticated. There's really no getting around that. 10 years ago, if somebody said that you could get a backup camera in a base model import car, they'd probably laugh, but now they're there. The mandated features like seatbelt sensors on fire trucks now, even fire trucks that are refurbished, if you have a new truck, you've got a little monitor above the operator station and it shows red dots for all the seatbelt locations. And they click green when the seatbelts are engaged. So you can tell who's got your seatbelt on and who doesn't. The comparable trucks that are out there, the town of Bolton purchased a similar truck from Rosenbauer, all-wheel drive unit. They took delivery of it this year. They spec'd it out 2 years ago, and it was $480,000. The other trucks in the area that have been purchased, South Deerfield just purchased a new rescue truck. It was pretty expensive. Also, more than what we're doing. And then also, Waitley and Montague Center purchased trucks, but they were fortunate enough to find demonstrator trucks that were very similar to what they wanted. There was a demonstrator truck out there a year and a half ago, similar to what we wanted, but it's no longer available. Bottom line is, the truck could easily cost $150,000, $200,000 more. We declined most of the options that were out there. Some of the things that we did not go with, digital versus analog gauges. We went with as many analog gauges as we could. We cut down on all the electronics to the extent that we could. The onboard computers and the scene management devices, we didn't buy them. So we'll just use a tablet for that when that technology comes around. Aluminum versus stainless steel, there is a big cost difference. This truck that we have in mind is an all aluminum truck. The stainless steel versions that we saw were more expensive, and it adds a little bit of question when it comes to finishing inside the truck, and also just the rigidity of the body and so forth. Features to tool storage racks, all sorts of little compartments, knickknacks here and there. We asked the manufacturers to eliminate the most expensive items and put in the simple things. The cubby with a door on it versus this elaborate pull-out thing on an arm that spins like a lazy Susan in your kitchen. That's not something that we'd specified. Also, emergency lights, we went with a good brand, but we went with a relatively simple layout for those lights. When it really comes down to it, as far as getting a rebid in before town meeting, the timeline isn't going to allow it due to the timing to get specifications reviewed. Also, the time that the bids have to be open. It's really a 4-week process when the bids are announced to when the bids are opened, because they've got to be open for about a week. There's a question period, then the bids have to be open for a while longer. So when it really started to add up, we realized that we were up against it, adding in the fact that a lot of the documents that we had to get into the USDA to officially apply for the loan had to be in the middle of this month, just for ease of everything. And then we also needed some different input for council and so forth for the actual warrant for town meeting.
What would be the reason for a rebid?
Well, if we wanted to have more than one tangible bid,
okay,
to have to go with our to go with our request at town meeting,
because
it's a reasonable question. It's something that a lot of people will bring up, and quite frankly, it was something that I was hoping to avoid with the way that we went about the whole process, but it just wasn't to be. So that's what I have. I'm open to any questions or any more discussion on the topic. And, thanks for bearing with me for 25 minutes here.
Thank you, Chief. Scott, questions?
Well, I met with the chief middle of last week and had a conversation about the timeline, the kind of brackets that we're stuck in. The brackets being the appropriation for town meeting. We're going out for a loan without an appropriation, right? We can't really as a municipality can't commit to that. And then the scale of the debt schedule. If it's $500,000, even 1%, you know, what's the mechanism? Is it going to be a band where you run an annual? Or is it going to be a 10-year loan or a 20-year loan that, again, plugs in to the budget? And are we going to approach it through the standard line item in the debt? Or would this be something we consider excluding so it comes off the rate at the end? Remember, as you plug debt onto an operating budget and you don't exclude it, it stays. It's on the rate. You raise that money, you make a step change, it stays, the debt goes away, the rate doesn't change, it doesn't drop back down. A debt exclusion, the debt goes away, that rate drops for exactly the value that you borrowed, proportionally. And those are important questions to bring forward. If you look at $500,000 and you plug in 10 years, so 50K a year, that's essentially 5 cents on the tax rate, 25K is 2.5, we're basically 10 cents for $100,000 in nice range as far as tax increases. So that's an important thing to bear in mind. So those kinds of discussions, I left the chief with homework and wanted to bring that forward, those discussions forward to the board. I appreciate the fact that you're squeezed on time, that the USDA does it by round. I get that. Frankly, we get better interest rates than they're offering, but that's a whole nother discussion. That's 2% or over the course. I think our last band was a 0.98 or 0.91. We got less than 1% because of the town's bond rating. So I was really clear with the chief, and I'm clear with all the department heads. There's a reason we hire really good people to do good work, and we don't get involved in second-guessing them. Sometimes it feels it. We'll have that discussion about numbers, but it's not any kind of motive. If there's a need that's warranted for a truck, we got to talk about a truck. It's an expensive truck, but that's okay. It does good work. That's kind of where I'm at.
David?
No specific questions right now. I'm just thinking about the funding formula. Sure. And stuff. So
Chief, I went back and I did, after you were there, I went back and looked at different manufacturers and see what trucks cost. What I did find was that it's not unusual to find a truck going for $500,000, so very common for a pumper truck, which I was quite surprised. I have no idea why would only one, see that, and that's what, I hope you understand, that's one thing that really concerned me, when you only get one person that bids.
Mm-hmm.
What makes that bid so special?
Well, the other thing is, it's also very common to only get one bid. More common than not. A lot of times that second bid is what you might call a Hail Mary by another manufacturer that either doesn't fit at all or isn't even close in terms of being in that ballgame.
I know the last, I bought a jet rod truck and there was one that met every specification, and there was one that was just that. The guy, it didn't have, he wanted sensors here, this, reels, safety devices, and didn't have it. And he said, what'd you? And he says, well, if nobody bid and you really wanted it, maybe you would have picked mine.
Right.
So I understand that. But I did find out that it's not uncommon to have to spend $500,000 on a truck. It could go lower. I mean, I saw some go for like $410,000. But again, I don't know if you're what you're comparing. I see that you're having six versus four. The size of cab was a concern.
Yes.
I agree with you. If you say $20,000-$25,000 for all-wheel drive, I just wonder then why doesn't everybody else have an all-wheel drive for $20,000? Seems like it'd be a common thing. So it seems like it'd be more expensive than that. I guess I would ask about the demo unit, demos and/or stuff that's already built. If that's an option, or if you looked at those.
We did, and one of the challenges is in town for really the last 30 years, if you look at the truck we're replacing and the truck we have now, for a lot of reasons, we have a preference for a mid-mount pump, meaning that the pump operator is up out of the road, not standing on the side, and that does a couple of things. It gives that pump operator better visibility of the scene, keeps them out of people walking back and forth, and also keeps them out of the road. So in this instance of a car fire, what have you. What prompted Sunderland to get the top mount pump was a firefighter in the area got hit by a car at a car fire on the highway. And by having that mid-mount pump, they're up, they're out of the way, and that does add a little bit of cost. Some of the other things that we've learned the hard way about on the last truck we've put in terms of larger defrosters. Some of the things with lights we've asked for as well, just because we've proven that without them, we've got to rig something up, either hold flashlights through the window. And it's a tough thing to buy a truck that, whether it costs $300,000, $400,000, or $500,000, you get it and you say, well, now we got to do this because we didn't have that. So what we're trying to do is avoid a lot of I won't say buyer's remorse, but avoid a lot of wish we could have in this and be smart about what we choose and what we don't, and then bring something before the town that we're going to be able to live with for 30 years or more, and something that we're not going to have to put money into to maintain or to fix prematurely. The truck is probably the most heavily spec'd, meaning the weight capability of the axles and the suspension is the same or heavier than the other ones that we looked at. And same thing with the gauge of the frame, going for a galvanized frame for corrosion inhibiting, because we've already started to see some rust on our current engine 3 that we still hope to get another 15 years out of. So things like that we've looked at and decided, well, is it worth it? Is it not worth it? Yeah, this is worth it. And there might be $25,000 or $35,000 of that in the truck. Let's do this because we've learned this. Let's add this because we've had a bad experience with that. That sort of thing. Let's bump the price a little bit more than what you normally might have.
So did you guys hire an expert in the field to help you with it, or was this just members of the department?
It was members of the department. The challenge with hiring a consultant is a lot of them aren't truly independent. They've all got some tie to either a manufacturer or some entity that would have an interest. And while it might be far enough away that on paper it's no real issue, it's very difficult to get somebody from the outside to give you advice about what you should have on your fire truck, as opposed to folks that have been doing it for, we had even some of the retired firefighters helped us put this together. People that spec'd out the original engine 3 that were two that were replacing.
Last question for me is how much more money are you going to need to outfit the truck with hoses and stuff?
That's a good question. The hose we can take off of the current engine 2. That hose was new a couple of years ago and it hasn't been out in the sun. It's not moldy, it's in good shape. The hoses, the nozzles switch over. The radio can switch over. There isn't going to be an awful lot. That was a concern going forward. along the similar school of thought to, do we go for the Scott packs? Do we go for the SCBA packs with the truck? No, that was just going to make it, quite frankly, very hard to defend. And all of a sudden we're at $550,000, $580,000. It's really not going to be much. There's a little bit in the specification. There's an alternate for some extra lights on the back, a few thousand dollars, for another person to go out to the final inspection of the truck before it's delivered, so it can be viewed and any changes can be made. Just so we have three people going from the department instead of two. And then there was a $5,000 contingency as the last one for different things while the truck is being built. If we see it and we say, no, we'd rather have this over here, and they say, well, it's going to be an extra $500. There's little chance anything's going to wash for a little bit of that. So there are some options that we don't have to take for alternates, but Tom, there won't be much needed to outfit it. We've got the hose. We've got a lot of the things that are going to go in the truck.
Hey, Chief. You have any more questions?
No, that's all.
Katie?
No, I don't.
Audience, have any questions about a fire truck? Lauren?
What happens to engine two? Do we get to trade it in or sell it? Or?
Well, good question, too. The manufacturers won't take it as a trade. I broached that subject, and they said, well, we'll hook you up with a broker. And the value of it, probably somewhere in the neighborhood of $5,000 to $15,000. So it might end up as an irrigation pump for a farmer, or it could end up with a collector. Our last truck ended up with a collector. It was auctioned, and that doesn't mean it's more expensive or it demands a better price. It just means that it goes somewhere and it's not going to rust away. So the value is relatively small.
Any other questions? Okay. I guess we'll decide next week, Todd?
Yeah.
Thank you, Steve.
Okay, thanks.
Hopefully, the finance committee will be here, or we'll have a discussion next week.
We're going to have it plugged in.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Steve.
Okay, next up, Scott wanted a discussion regarding possible override to Sunderland Elementary School. Scott, you want to start?
Yeah, if I could. Obviously, I was out last week. I was at work and heard the bits and pieces of the discussion, and I wanted to raise the point to the board and to the residents that in the last couple of years, the elementary school in particular has exceeded our capacity both in 2.5 and new growth. So to give you an order of magnitude, in the year 2017, our total 2.5, we talk about 2.5 a lot, we throw it around like it's the law. Well, 2.5 also is a percentage. Our additional 2.5% in 2017 to the levy of the prior year, that's what that 2.5 is, we have to stay in that, was $112,000. $112,346. This is all from the Bureau of Division of Local Services at DOR. Our new growth estimate was $40,000 for a total of $153,000 total. So all new growth and 2.5 last year was $153,000. Of course, last year the elementary school budget had its own drivers, and it was nearly $400,000. 2016, our new growth was, I'm sorry, our 2.5%. Again, we hear about the revenue side in the selectman's office quite a bit. Our total 2.5 addition from the prior year, which was 2014, was $108,900. With new growth of $23,000, total of $131. 2014, it was $105,000 with new growth of $38,000. In the last 10 years, our total new growth in the town of Sunderland, that's all growth, not the 2.5, has only been $194,000 and $194,675. So in 10 years of growth, we have added $194,000 of recurring revenue we can count on in the town. And in the last 2 years, the elementary school's growth has been $407,704. Now, I think we have to have an honest discussion about an override. Yeah.
That's assuming the projected.
That's 17, 18.
Right.
Yeah, 17 and 18. Yeah. Just 2 years. Those 2 years alone doubled the expense of 10 years of new growth in town. And that's just not sustainable. So I think it's really important we have an honest discussion about a reset of the tax rate. The question is, what's the methodology, right? We squeeze departments. We use free cash. We actually have a free cash guideline we use for a percentage of free cash that comes in, goes directly to the operating budget. Some goes to capital stabilization. Some moves forward in the upcoming year because you have to have some free cash moving forward. If we take the last couple of years of growth at the elementary school and plug them together, average them out, 2 years of growth, include some of the indirects, because again, a recurring revenue has got to match a recurring expense, right? So recurring expense also includes the benefits. The elementary school themselves don't necessarily, the school committee doesn't deal with the benefit side of that. We do on the treasurer collector side. So we see that as well. So the actual growth, although employment isn't growing exponentially, it's still an expense that's worth considering. And so I'm going to put it in front of the board to entertain the discussion of about a $380,000-ish override that would allow us to be reset for coming years with growth in the elementary school. We hear growth in the elementary school. And I say this in the context that if we go a couple of years and everything smooths out, you know, we look wonderful. If we go a couple of years and we're on this kind of rate and it's $700,000, we look like knuckleheads, right? That's why I'm bringing it forward to the board. Not to vilify the elementary school, the people who work there, but it's just math. So that's my shtick. That's what I wanted to bring forward. I understand the school committee met. There was a reduction, Patty, of what, 3,000, 30,095?
Yes.
Okay, got that.
Like
if you could just send it, we'll plug it in the big sheet. That'll be helpful for us. But those numbers, again, those are pretty startling over a two-year trip, and we hear there's going to be more coming. And again, a lot of people, you know, other than us and the treasurer collector, won't go and understand those numbers. We only talk about an average of about $130,000 over 10 years we add to the expense, I'm sorry, to the revenue side of the ledger. Everybody else gets squeezed. Library gets squeezed, highway gets squeezed, cops get squeezed, capital gets squeezed. So that's what I wanted to talk about. The mechanism is a little clunky. You have to vote a budget, right? You have to vote a budget contingent. And either have another funding source or go back and revisit the budget.
Doug?
Yeah, I'm just to give a little
please.
Context for the increase at elementary, which, you know, obviously those are big increases in the last 2 years.
Yeah, right.
And as we talked about when we were here a week ago, we're still using school choice in an unsustainable way. So you're absolutely right. There's, I'd say, easily $125,000 less out of school choice, my opinion, next year that we should be using compared to this year. What's driving that is the growth in numbers at the elementary school. In those last 2 years, while the budget went up 10% and 6.5%, the enrollment, resident enrollment, not including the choice in, went up 15.2% and 11.6%. 2 years before that, it went up 9.3%. So we went from where we bottomed out after kids leaving town after the, you know, disaster of the FY10 budget, of we bottomed out at 150, resident PK through six, we're at 212, resident PK through six. It's a similar story even if you take the preschool out of it. You know, it went up 12.8% 2 years ago, 10.7% this year. So the good news is kids are back in our school. Unlike some of our peer towns, the demographics in Sunderland, we actually have young people in the, school-age kids more in the town than we did 10 years ago.
which is not true of our peers in the union. But we do, and we have to pay for it somehow. We've been, using the rainy day funds of school choice, and we've been pushing it to the limit to keep the budgets, within, under an override kind of threshold.
That lasts for a couple of years, though. I think
exactly.
we've been through the other side where it's been decimating and have to build it back up. Now we're at a different place.
Yeah. So the good news is, we've got a great elementary school, people doing a great job over there, and they, worked some magic for years, along with people in the town and the commitment, and make it a place where people, want to keep their kids in the school from a number of places from neighboring towns want to send kids into the school, and we're judicious about how we open up school choice. And so that's the real positive news, but we can't keep paying for it out of because you like to have a whole year in advance of the choice money sitting in your account, just as, again, that's that kind of rainy day fund. And we've been tapping, and we're now spending the current part of the current years, and the majority of the current years. I mean, we're just not leaving enough buffer, and so that's the situation we're in. And I think you're absolutely right. So something has to be done to put it on a sustainable path, and I hope that wouldn't be making the kind of draconian cuts that we did 10 years ago or whatever, 9 years ago, because that led to a massive exodus, and in fact, the town didn't save nearly as much money as was cut out of the budget, because when you factor in and what you're paying for the school choice out and the charter kids out, it's not a pretty picture.
Sure.
As we all talked about at the time, and it happened. So you could actually
frame the majority of what you just described, flip it and sit in this seat, and it's the same animal. We want to be as responsible as possible so that it is sustainable, so that we help you avoid completely that trap of a really big hole.
Yeah. And the other thing, and Patty got me a lot of various pieces of information to help me look at some of this over the time trend. And, but then another, again, kind of looking at our peer schools in the union, it's not like we're going crazy on a spending spree. In fact, our per pupil spending, which, those numbers, there's different things that go into that, including, needs and things like that. But I think it's pretty comparable across somewhat. In fact, if anything, our needs might be higher. That's anecdotal. I'm not sure those numbers are exact. That's true. But our per pupils at right now at 13,000, just over 13,000. Deerfield's almost 15, Waitley's 16.5, Conway's almost 17. So we're not going crazy. Sure. We're making the most, and I think we've done a great job of making the most of what we do spend. But again, we're just so to try to cut that budget would be brutal.
Just to add, the per pupil does include the costs that the town incurs for the benefits, because we report
that goes in, right?
That goes in.
That makes perfect sense.
So it does go in there. What was surprising to me when I did this data was 314 communities reporting. Mm-hmm. You guys are 281 in spending.
We've been trying really hard.
You're in the bottom 10% of all school districts.
Sure. It's interesting. Again, I wanted to bring this forward because we have a relatively narrow window before the warrant is closed and we have decisions to make around budgeting. I don't see how that kind of growth, and just as a matter of order of magnitude, last year was the first year, 2017 was the first year the elementary school cost to the town were actually greater than 2009. So again, there's no villains, there's no rescuers, there's no persecutors, it's none of that. This is just math.
Yep.
Well, and Scott, don't forget that was mandated because we weren't meeting in school spending per DESE's requirements.
Right. Well,
and then the other thing I think we need to look at is I agree with what you're saying about the revenues.
Yep.
And Chapter 70 isn't getting, but those years, all that money you were spending in choice and charter out, that is increasing your revenue because it's not being deducted from the Chapter 70.
Yep, I appreciate that. And, there's also a sidebar discussion or tangential discussion about choice wouldn't be even a discussion if it was simply cost of attendance. I've been an advocate of cost of attendance. Make it cost of attendance to send your kid to Braintree. I don't care, right? It shouldn't be a $5,000 cap. Cost of attendance and everything goes away. All the shenanigans, all the signs, all that stuff goes away. Anyway, so again, yeah, that's tangential.
No, but that 2009, it's true, right? We crossed that threshold.
Yeah.
Again, like perspective on that, you know, in 2000, FY09, we had 186 resident PK through 6, 212 this year.
Sure.
So it's, you know, and we just crossed it. And you know, I know the town budget hasn't kept pace with inflation over that period, and ours, you know, this is all like just nominal dollars, let alone if you factor in inflation.
Sure. That's a really good point as well. Fortunately, we've been in there. So with respect to scale, again, I asked Sherry to put together an average of the last two plus a percentage of the indirects for the staff, just to make it give us an order of magnitude, right? And it's in the 380 range.
What is that number?
About $380,000 for an override question.
Okay. It would be
to plug into our revenue stream to pay for this year's budget, and then recognize that we have revenues going forward in future years. Again, you're effectively resetting our appropriations capacity.
And does that, if we're talking about this, I just want to make sure that we are considering, you know, what I was talking about earlier about the choice situation for next year, and that's one that's, again, it's,
so what I've heard from a couple of members of the school committee is that next year we can expect another piece of growth.
Yeah, even with the current, that our ability to cut school choice that fine, again, I think we shouldn't be doing it.
Joey?
We want to coordinate with you guys and make sure that we're doing the right thing for the years going forward.
In fact, not only should we're spending more in this year's budget out of choice, then we will take in this year.
Yep.
It's just because we still have some
prior year.
Prior years.
Unsustainable regardless.
Correct.
So, Scott, could you tell us how that would work? Like, would our appropriation be in the town budget?
That's
or does it not happen until the override, and then we have nothing if the override doesn't pass?
That's a part of our discussion, and that's the rugged part. I don't want to, in the discussion, I certainly do not want to set a trap for anybody who needs an appropriation. We just had a $500,000 fire truck looking to see what the timeline is. That's a really good question. It's bond council, borrowing authorization, town meeting, numbers to plug in here. That doesn't happen in 4 weeks for $500,000 at a municipal level. The answer to your question is, if it's contingent, then an override fails, we'd have to either backfill this year, which we're close. It looks like we're about, with the $30,000, we're in about $40,000 in the hole right now on the total town budget and the appropriations, total town appropriations and the revenue that we're projecting.
That includes the...
Yep, right now. So if the override fails, we can muddle through this year with a bunch of different... we can grab more free cash. We can do all the same things, right, that we have been doing. But that doesn't set us up for next year, where we get likely another, and this again is from the DLS, $100,000, $112,000 and 2.5%, and maybe $30,000 or $40,000 in new growth. We're same situation. And a different scale, I might add. Frontier could come in differently. We could have four people go to the tech school. We could have two people go to Smith. And then, well, what happens? It's really significant. There's a couple of places, you know, because of the district agreement, there's a couple of places that we have to go to when we make significant cuts. We go to departments, and we go to the elementary school.
And again, you know, given that our growth of the elementary school growth, I mean, that's shifting over gradually over to Frontier, so our share of that is going to go up.
Move that away.
Over time.
Where you guys have been the winners, the last 2 years, because you've had the lowest increase in the assessment. I mean, we definitely can see that with the 5-year average, because it's like a double whammy. Because not only are you the only, you've got growth, but no one else is.
Right.
They've got declining.
Sure.
So it's like you've got to pick up the declining plus the.
Sure. I see that for that assessment formulation being the roulette wheel, and there's more and more and more and more red, and we're the red ball coming around. And it's just more and more and more and more of it. Tom? Thank you.
So I had one question from last week where we're looking at how long have we considered, or do we consider Sunderland Elementary pre-K through 6 to budget now, or is it K through 6?
Pre-K.
All right.
I mean, the numbers are, I looked at it both ways. The numbers are
My question is, if next year, so next year by adding a second pre-K, we're expanding the school, right? You're expanding attendance. What's that?
Right now we still have a 3-year-old program and a 4-year-old. They're both half days. And then at the preschool, it's tuition funded. So a lot of those, right. And so those salaries come from the tuition.
So you get a fee for service on the pre-K? Or a portion of the pre-K programs?
The peer partners pay tuition. The pre-K is a SPED model.
Yep.
So we do get, for every one pre-K kid that receives SPED services, mm-hmm. we get a 0.5
sure.
on our foundation enrollment.
Okay.
But I was curious, to what extent is this, is there any extent this is, you know, driven by, you know, having, you know, doing the full day pre-K, but again, like the numbers from the resident K through 6, you know, FY 14, it went up 10.4%, and we had a lull in 15, 16, it went up 12.8%, 17, 10.7%. So that's K through 6, resident, again, factoring out all the choice. So,
Doug, you had alluded to it earlier, when the budget issues in FY10, mm-hmm. when we had all those students go out of district, this year, for a minimal cost of around $5,000, we created a full-day preschool program, first time at Sunderland, for about 7 kids. So 25 students are there for half the day, either AM or PM, and then we have this cohort who are there throughout the entire day. Because studies have shown, research has shown that early intervention is key. Now, if these students were to go somewhere else outside of Sunderland and receive those full day services, there's no guarantee that they would be coming back upon entering kindergarten, which would in turn increase school choice out.
Yeah.
It's not a flat $5,000 if there's
It would be tuition. So it would be the cost of a private. And once you have that out-of-district placement in your IEP, it's very difficult for parents to come back.
So is that I have to ask candidly, is that a strategy for increasing enrollment throughout? Basically, you're making a farm team so they stay in Sunderland?
No, it's because we have to give services from the age of 2.9.
Got it.
So if you're eligible,
so there's a statute.
Yeah. We own them.
Got it.
So I don't want to say own them. Yeah. We're responsible for them. And if we don't provide the services in school, then we have to pay for them to get them out of school.
Okay. Got it. That makes sense.
And the expense of that, long term, is
sure.
way more than if we,
right.
we don't get funded.
The bottom 10% of the spending.
Right, right. No, you raise a good point. I think that's a point of clarification that's important. If it's a required program and we're keeping residents of Sunderland's kids in the program, it makes sense.
And a number that we're very proud of is that we have 6 students, K through 6 right now, choicing out.
Right.
In town. So it's pretty significant.
So I believe I have more homework to do about our ability to raise within our levy limit. But again, I want to have it on the table in front of the board. That's an area of concern that I think we should be addressing. I sat in that chair. Many of you were in this room when the oxygen left in 2009. I don't want to do that again.
Well, if I could.
Yeah.
It's interesting to hear Doug's comments, because just last week when we had a concern with Frontier budget, I heard, well, Tom, you're the only one that has that concern. Well, we should be concerned. $157,000 out of E&D, where 3 years ago they just said we're not going to put any E&D in the budget. another 100,000 from school choice that they hadn't been using to put. So we have, it's almost, you can see it's being repeated at Frontier. It's $257,000 of non-reoccurring funds that are being used. I would also add one thing, Doug, is that to try to help the budget, you're stretching your school choice. Well, we're stretching our available funds also, and our available funds are free cash, stabilization, raise and appropriate.
Yeah.
And so we're in this together.
I completely concur.
And I know we kind of had a discussion, but that's why it's a tough. Most of the time, being a selectman is not a bad job. Most of the time. But when we get the next 3 or 4 weeks, 5 weeks, 6 weeks, is usually very difficult because we're trying to balance $500,000 fire truck, 6% increase for the library director. We have town people that have been working in the town for a number of years that have fallen way behind, and you're trying to be. I'm not going to say fair because it doesn't have the impact. I don't know what the right word is, but you try to make sure that we can try to keep growing together. But sometimes it's very difficult, and it's like say, okay, last year you had your 10% increase, keep that. All right. We'll bite the bullet for this year for you guys who need it. Now we need to try to help somebody else. But right now it's compounding every year.
So we get this big spreadsheet that on any given year is like whack-a-mole. You hit it this year and it pops up over there, and the same thing pops up over here, and we end up with this goofy cap. And again, I don't want to belabor the point, but a lot of people don't really know the numbers. Like that 2.5%. 2.5% is $112,000. That's it.
But I mean, again, like, well, you know, for us, I think everybody has unpredictabilities in their department.
Correct.
But, you know, the number of kids we are educating in a given year, you know, when it can, you know, go up 15%,
right.
You know, that's something we got to deal with. You know, and, you know, overall, again, I kind of looked at it, well, I mean, I know the whole town was hammered in this, and the limitations of what we can do with Frontier, but like looking at the elementary, and this is through this FY18, going from pre the bottom falling out FY09 through 18, you know, an increase of 10.2% for the elementary, 10.8% for the town as a whole.
Right.
So it's not like the elementary's gone nuts, and again, in the context of the enrollment going up by 14% over that period, inflation 13%,
right.
And we're doing everything and more to kind of.
Well, I would certainly expect if an override discussion continues, the discussion continues, if it comes to fruition and we can have a little breathing room for the remaining elements of our budget, that we wouldn't be getting seeing, you know, gold plates in the cafeteria. It's not your style. You guys,
right.
It doesn't work that way.
Yeah.
I get it.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Mr. Moderator, as we talk about the warrant and the warrant article, back to Patty's question about mechanism, there is a way of keeping town meeting open, voting a budget. We have the capacity to pay for this year if we squeeze. We're going to talk to the personnel committee. We have police negotiations that are going on. We have a whole bunch of things that are challenges this year. But I would be remiss as a member of the senior elected team to not bring this forward and say we need about $370,000 to $380,000 on the tax rate, or we need to make those cuts because they're coming. I love the silence when the word override comes in.
Oh, we had the same discussion at the school committee meeting,
right.
Basically, you know, because you can squeak by this year, but
correct,
it's staring at us over the threshold for next year. So, and it's one of those things. It's like you said, it, everybody could love the budget, but the bottom line is somehow we're going to have to grapple with the math. I actually have one question too. What percentage after this budget, because this was, I think, after you had left, Patty, what percentage of the remaining budget is grant funded? Because that's also something that we kind of have to mentally take into account as an at-risk portion of the budget, because potentially anything that's grant funded for, or any grant funding that we use for ongoing expenses, we could lose the grants for it.
Right now, we're projected to use $63,616 from the IDEA, which is a federal grant, and Title I, $15,806.
The
IDEA, we've been good with as far as not having large decreases, but Title I, every year we're falling further down the ladder now. Sunderland, of our four towns, has the highest grant reduced lunch, so Sunderland always gets a little bit more than everybody else. But and then we've also got some revolving funds. Now, after we go through a full year of early childhood revolving, and if we have the parents of the peer partners paying their tuition, right now we allocate $20,000 as a salary offset into that revolving fund. We may be able to go up on that next year if the money is in.
All set?
Yep. Thank you.
You all set?
Yeah.
Can I ask another question?
Absolutely.
Being a city girl, how does that override happen? Does that get voted on, like, on the floor, or does that go on the ballot?
It's a ballot question. So the mechanism is an appropriation at town meeting. And depending on how the budget is, how the warrant article is phrased, the funding sources are in the front of the article, the expenses are at the back of the article. And then if the article is to be contingent on an override, then we would have to have a second town meeting for an appropriation if the override fails. Yeah, either way, you've got to vote. You have to vote the expense, and you have to have a match. If the two are out of sync, and we are out of sync by one week between our town meeting and our annual election, and we actually have until April 3rd to put a ballot question on. So that's one of the reasons this whole night seems to be a sense of urgency. I looked at the calendar and went, oh, here we go. So that's the mechanism. And as you know, even being from the big city, we always run cash accounting.
Right.
Okay.
That part.
I was in the Pacific Northwest and talking to one of the county business managers out there for the county Seattle happens to sit in, and he's like, "You run the whole cap? Were you out of your mind?" I said, "Well, it just took a couple of good thieves, and then the voters rolled in and said, no, we're doing it differently."
If you need, obviously, additional information from us, like around the choice picture or any of that.
Well, what I would say, Doug, is I won't speak for the board, but I'm personally not going to mix any words that the driver here is the elementary school, and this is a driver. This is driven by the elementary school.
Yep.
It's not the waste treatment plant. It's not the police department. It's not the library.
Right.
You know, we got $500,000 in 2 years. We can't support that. If anything that we're going to need if this moves forward is we're going to need a really big piece of help turning people out. Because it's really going to be on that program.
Well, I don't think that'll be lacking.
I understand.
Yeah.
John.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm Bob.
Robert.
Looking at the budget.
Yeah.
I'm looking at page 6 of last week. That's if I just do the straight math in terms of students versus staff. Last year, or the current year, the ratio was about 5 staff. That's after factoring out the nurse and the janitorial. There's about 5 staff in the school, a little over 5 staff. A little over 5 students per staff member. Next year, it's going to drop down to, I think, 4.74 students per staff member. And the question that I have is, why are there so many staff or personnel associated with the school, because that's what's driving the budget.
Three people right here. You're looking at the wrong side of the table.
I can help answer that. Part of the reason is the special education services that we have to provide for students on IEPs. So that could be a one-on-one, which is you have to have one instructional assistant with you all the time to assist you in the classroom, or you have partial one-on-one services for part of the day, and then we share that IA with another student that has partial services. You're also looking at, we've had increases in our speech and our OT and our PT, which is occupational therapy, physical therapy, and speech. And as Karen Fiorentino, our SPED director, said, our SPED kids are our general pop kids. We have our one specialized classroom. These kids are all in there. So then you have to work on differentiation. The teacher's got to be in the room working with, and again, let's not also forget that Sunderland has our highest ELL, English language learners. So again, that's more services that we have to provide for students.
In the same...
I mean, it seems as though we're getting, when you look at the ratios, you know, we're beyond private schools.
Well, I would want to count those out.
Private schools don't deal with the needs that public schools deal with. So I think I think that's a poor point of comparison. I will say, I don't know if you've ever been to a basketball game that Ben has coached. There aren't a lot of details going on the court that he isn't paying attention to every second of the game. It's pretty apparent. And efficiencies that he expects out of his team when they're out there. And I'll tell you, it's just the exact same thing in that school building. And go and spend some time with them and you'll see somebody who's on top of their game and on top of their team. And you know, I think delivering an incredible product on not an extravagant budget. So say enough for the job that he does and the administration supporting that effort. So,
Dr. Perry?
Thank you. I am the superintendent, for those of you who haven't met me yet, I'm Superintendent Dr. Lynn Carey. The same way that the school, the elementary school, is driving your budget, mm-hmm. special ed has that same way of driving our budget.
Sure.
The only thing different is we are required by law. We cannot violate any of these free and appropriate education laws, IDEA, which is Individuals with Disabilities Act, or Section 504 of the Americans with Disabilities. We cannot violate any of those. We, as we said last week, but you weren't here, so I will tell you that we have a very specialized program that is housed at Sunderland School. It's called Horizons. This program saves many hundreds of thousands of dollars by keeping students, Sunderland students, who can't function, who will probably never be able to function without a lot of support. That means a lot of people around them. And those children we are responsible for until they reach the age of 22. In addition, we do have a pre-K, and it's not a money-making process, but we do get revenue. We also get revenue from the other program as well. Students can, you know, they do move in. Some of these IAs that are counted on this are actually paid for by the districts that are sending those children to us. So we do have that kind of tuition, the revolving account that Patty was referring to. With our early children, we have, I don't know how many students are in there now, if it's 20, how many students do we have in there?
For what?
All of them, 3s and 4-year-olds in pre-K.
30 or 31.
All right, so we have 31 now. 11 of those children, our children, because we don't bring anyone else in,
right.
11 of those children are multiply disabled.
Mm-hmm.
6 of them have autism. And if you know anything about autism, it's a very high level, it's on a spectrum, but these children need to have someone with them pretty much all the time, or they will hurt themselves, hurt others, cause unknown damage. We just need to be aware and with those children. So while if we didn't have children that fell outside the bell curve, the normal, you know, whatever the average is, we wouldn't have as many IAs. But because, for whatever reason, Sunderland has a population of students who are very, very needy, and because they have IEPs, and because those are legal documents that we do not want to be brought into Boston to defend that we're not doing or doing the right thing. Those parents can turn us in, you know, like, whatever. There's just a lot of things involved. Because we have those children, we need to have the adult support to protect those children and to protect their right to a free and appropriate education. Some of them are able to move in and out of regular ed classrooms. Some of them are in substantially separate programs where they don't really, you know, they move around the building, but they don't sit in a classroom and, like, you know, typical students would. So that's really what is running our budget, our school, and our number of IAs, because there's been a lot of talk about why do you have so many instructional assistants. We can't turn our back for 1 minute on any of these children. We just can't. And the fact that we do have a pre-K and that we've opened it up and we're doing that cheap, we're cutting a hole in the wall, and that's how we're opening. No new bathrooms, no new windows, no new buildings. We're cutting a hole in the wall and putting a door in so the kids can use the same bathroom. We're doing it on the cheap. We took a locker room this year and put a bunch of padding in it, and that is our OT and PT room, because these children that come in with these high level of differences and or multiple disabilities, they have to have, by law, they have to have occupational therapy. They have to have speech therapy. They have to have physical therapy. There's no room. You can't do it in the hallway. They took a locker room and padded it and made it into a place for them to get those services. We're cutting a hole in the wall. We're getting rid of our art and music room so that we can house these little children. There's so many drivers in our budget that we cannot, the same way, we can't say no to. We have to have them.
Well, we have a parallel, if I could, there, Superintendent. We have to fund it.
And
the reason for this discussion is to be responsible and honest about how it's funded.
Right. And I agree. We're doing everything we can.
Right.
I don't believe the state's going to come in and say that we're not doing due diligence with those students.
I appreciate that.
Scott, to answer Mr. Moderator's question, if I count the direct service to students, I'm not going to count the library, the counselor, or any special ed. This year, we're 5.7. to 1.
Okay.
Next year we're going to be 5.4. So it did drop 0.3.
Are those full-time equivalent?
Yes.
That's including IAs as well as obviously classroom teachers
IAs, and classroom teachers, art and music.
John wanted to say something. Mm-hmm. John wanted to say something.
So there's 40 employees there?
Altogether,
John,
there's
3.7.
We're almost at 16.
Full-time
7.8.
We're
going to
be at 57.9 next year,
and
this year we're at
53.7. Hate to be that 0.7,
I just had a question about, and this is maybe not a fair question.
No, questions are good.
It just sort of occurred to me that if we're in the lowest 10% of the state per student,
per pupil spending,
yeah.
And we're the lowest in our group of towns that has elementary schools, but we keep running into these huge cost increases, but we're still, our prices are way, 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 way down.
It's interesting, isn't it?
There's a problem with the amount of money we're taking in. It's the same problem we had 10 years ago.
Right.
So why haven't we fixed that? And is there no mechanism to fix that problem?
Well, that's why I'm
but it seems like we come into these cliffs rather than a slow from one way or another.
We actually have been slow.
The next thing we do, we got to break
they,
up
they,
the
they have, No, they have been slow. And we've been, and again, and it's interesting, John, and it's just, and you can see it happening in Frontier right now. okay, our assessment is going to go up 3.3% this year at Frontier, right? I think something like that.
$25,000.
Whatever that, it's so, or no, actually, maybe we're like 1.74%. Maybe Deerfield was 3.3.
I think ours is less than 3.
Yeah, I think we were 1.74. But see, but the way that happened is how the money, they're going to...
1.47.
Thank you. But what's going to happen is that we're using different funds to offset that expense. This year they're using $157,000 from E&D and $100,000 from School Choice. They're going to pay for this year. So that's $257,000 that's not put onto our levy, that their assessments that are coming to the towns. Same thing happened in Sunderland, and Doug was saying it earlier. They were starting to use their school choice money, and they're applying school choice money against the budget. We were using free cash to help balance the budget. So a combination of that school choice money and free cash, we were able to make the budgets work. Well, every year we say, you know, we're going to use X amount of dollars, but this is non-reoccurring, and typically people vote their pocketbook. And they pass the budget, just like at Frontier. Because really, if you took that 257 and actually put it back into the town, we would end up with another 30% of that budget, so another $60,000. That would really be, if you're someone that worked on a cash form of business, that's what you would do. Because then it would tell people, this is what your true assessment is.
If I could, John.
My question to you is, are you proud of that number?
Me?
Yeah, of the 10%, but we're in the lowest 10% of the state. As a board, are you proud of that number?
Well, A, I have to find out how it's done.
Because that's my concern, is that it's not really a number that I'm particularly proud of, because we all pay a lot of taxes, and to still be in the lowest 10% of educational spending for our elementary school is something to me is not necessarily something to be proud of.
Sure. They raise a good point. Levy limits, right? If we bust...
I don't understand all the mechanisms. Yeah. I'm just saying, I'm not proud of that fact.
Sure.
But I'd be more proud to say that we were putting more energy into our school than 10%, or lower than 10%. So
I guess...
I don't understand. I know you guys struggle. Yeah. I know it's a real pain.
I have to go... And what I need to do is I need to go back and look at the numbers, where the numbers came from, to understand why
that 10%. The Department of Education.
So I don't believe in all this. The Holyoke schools and Springfield schools and the Boston schools, and we're in the lowest 10%.
I mean, that's what's concerning.
And I can tell you where some of that comes from, John. A few years, it wasn't too long ago when I looked at state aid, right? Sunderland was getting almost 65% of our school budget, elementary budget, was from state aid.
Right.
You know what that percentage is now?
Considerably
less than like 20 or less, 20%. So we went from 65% to 20%. It's almost like going back to free cash versus, you know, using free cash and or school choice and or E&D money. We're still trying to recoup that percentage where we're 60 when we're getting 65%. You ask me today, I would say education is the cheapest thing that we pay for, because most of us understand what happens if you don't have education. The problem is, I can afford an increase in taxes, okay? And I voted for the override the last time. We had people here last week that voted no on the override, that's saying to spend the free cash on other things, and you're going to be coming in with a $100,000 citizen petition to pay for the 300 celebration. So you're asking me, and I'm saying no. I think you have to. I don't have a problem paying my fair share. 10%, if it's true, it's not good. I don't know how they come up with the numbers. I don't know what goes into the numbers.
If I could just...
I don't think that number is the important one. I think the number that's the important one is, where does Sunderland Elementary School and Frontier rank academically in the state, not in terms of how much money we get?
What, with level two?
Yeah, nice that you asked that.
Correlation between them.
Yeah, we discussed this last week a little bit too, and also, like, if you take that on face value, nobody can really be proud of that number. But I went into the numbers too, because one thing, to me, it's a little more important about where we're ranking around, like, closer to us. But without seeing what's in there, because any of those towns may have a much higher per capita income, so there's a lot of factors. That you gotta look at too.
Right, but the per pupil, it's everybody's report, it's coming from the end of the year reports that are filed. So
no, I'm not questioning, I get that.
The data is the same, but I agree with you. And there is some tweaking that can be done to look at that, because the technical schools are in that 314. If we took them out, you know, that's gonna greatly reduce. So, I mean, there is some more parsing we can do.
It's not just a number, though, because you have to look at every town's ability to raise revenue and to pay. And that's why you look at things like EQV and everything. So it's not, you can't just take that number and compare one town to another in a vacuum.
I don't put, like, in the absolutes that much. I don't know. I mean, again, like, there's so many things that go into it. But just roughly, in sort of the gross sense, and just looking at our peers in the union, we're in the bottom 10%, Deerfield in the above 50%, and Whately and Conway both in the top 30%.
Right, and that's a better number to look at.
You know, it definitely gives you a moment of pause, at least.
Sure.
But I think the bottom line issue is what we've been focusing on most of the night is how can we fund this sustainably
over
time?
Sure.
Well, I guess, every time we have approached a possible override, it's getting to the right number also that is going to give you a sustainable
bingo.
And, you know, I'm not sure what that is. I haven't looked at the numbers like you are, but I think the other things that we need to worry about are cuts in federal support for education, which are a big potential.
Sure.
I mean, so, you know, I think if we're going to do it, we need to plan to make it
sustainable
sure. for at least it. You know, and I think we try, you know, and how do we explain that in a compelling way?
Right. We also need to look at capital, too, because none of this discussion touches on capital at all. Mm-hmm. So we also have to factor that in, because we can't let, I mean, we can fund, let's say, our teachers and everything, but we can't let the buildings that they're in crumble around them either.
I mean, we took that huge cut in 2009, mm-hmm. and which we've never really totally recovered from. I mean, I think it's kind of amazing that we've gotten this many years.
We interrupted the trajectory, but it can be argued that we're up, as of last year, ahead of 2009, which is a terrible thing to say.
Yeah. In nominal dollars.
Yeah. Oh, you're absolutely right. I completely understand that. And again, that's across many of the town services.
Yeah. No, I know. That's what I'm saying. For the town as a whole,
right.
Above it, but just barely, and that's in nominal. That's
exactly
with
right.
Not taking into account inflation.
Correct.
And I would say that if you would listen, if discussions on this board since the override days, and I think the moderator will attest to this, had been if we were ever to catch up, an override was needed. I think we said it every year.
Mm-hmm. Saying
it
again.
No one listens, and no one. And there haven't been people beating down the door to say we need an override, except for the guy sitting up here on the thing, you know, sitting here, because we're the ones that look at the numbers better than anybody. And over the years, we've sent past superintendent, we'd send little emails, letters saying, you know, just so you know, our projected growth this year is going to be $120,000. Year one third of the budget, $120,000. One third is $40,000. You know, look for increasing your budget by $40,000. We've never seen an elementary Frontier budget or our budget come in at $40,000. We're always using extra things.
Right.
So we've known for a long time. We said it, but no one kind of listens to it because they're.
It's one of the reasons I was mainly animated to start off. You keep looking at it going, oh, to if I could answer directly your question, John, you know, the mechanism here is to accept and push back on the recommended budget by the professionals who develop it. I think the board can take a great deal of pride in not meddling in ed policy at all. Ben doesn't see me down there going, we need to talk, Ben.
You're welcome.
I understand. The police chief says the same thing, and I avoid him, too.
That's a different conversation.
I understand. Right. I speak for myself as a member of the board. We take a great deal of pride in hiring professionals and letting them do their job. That said, we've worked mightily to fund every appropriation that comes in front of us. This year, we have a little bit of capacity in the levy limit, not much, and we're going to grab a bunch of money from one time, and it looks like because we have a big charge of free cash because of a bunch of accounts got closed out, there could be a bum's rush on the bank. That's not going to happen. It can't, because it's not sustainable.
And believe me, no offense is taken with these tough questions.
No, I know.
Asked.
Oh, you guys are great.
And that's your job, and that's your elected responsibility for the town. At the same time, on my end, on the school committee's end,
yep,
it's our time. It's our job to present a budget that best meets the needs of the students,
correct,
the families in town. And I think it's a little unsafe to look at the student to staff ratio strictly by the numbers,
right,
because it's not, yeah, it doesn't paint a true picture.
Sure. It's a good point.
It runs so much deeper than that.
But you know, Ben, the only you say that, and I can tell you from personal experience, people come and say, and I think probably everyone in this room has heard it, have you seen how many cars are in that elementary school parking lot?
I actually heard somebody say that just last week.
And I bet you everybody here has heard that refrain at least once. Have you seen how many, Scott, and I can tell you that they asked me that the whole time. I said, look, I don't know what every position's in the elementary school is. You need to talk to your school committee members. They're the ones that represent us, all of us, on when it comes to the schools.
Yep.
And I can guarantee you the moderator didn't ask that question unless he's heard that question.
Right.
But that's a realization that we have to live with, is that people look at it and they say, well, you got 200 kids there and there's 50 cars. So I would tell people that they need a carpool. Or take public transportation.
Or
ride a bike.
How are the bike pathways?
But we are going to have to, we have pathway commission on for 7 o'clock, so.
And they're
I'm pretty sure the pathway commission people are not coming to tell us that they're not going to increase weight or they're probably looking for money.
So I just wanted to tell you, it's my 28th year in education, and I've worked at several districts to garner the experience that I have. I've heard it every single district. That is the oldest. That's the one. The cars in the parking lot. I've heard that.
Absolutely.
Last question. Can you help me understand what, and I'm asking Patty this too, we had to go up 10% last year.
Mm-hmm.
Was that the state telling us that we were underfunding our education?
That's correct. But if we don't meet net school spending minimum, the town won't get their Chapter 70 appropriation.
The state has this thing they call ability to pay.
Oh yeah, and it's not just the elementary school.
And it's the most difficult thing for to try to understand is this thing about ability to pay and what that means. But as I think it was Ben, somebody said last week, we had school choice kids coming out, and this is why it doesn't make sense. We had charter school kids going out as well. Well, those kids were going out at X amount of dollars per student.
Mm-hmm.
So all of a sudden those kids are coming back. Well, we were, according to the state, we were sending those kids out. So, and part of the other thing that's hard with school choice is that part of the school choice was actually on the town budget.
But it goes to the net school spending.
Right.
So when you didn't have it,
right,
when the projection didn't come to fruition, if they estimated you were going to have 200K going out, but it only came in at 190, we were 10K short on the school side of spending to get to net school spending.
We had one budget cycle prior to your tenure here, and we were paying 1.65 or 1.68 above minimum contribution, and the following year, we our ability to pay was factored into the formula, and it went up by another 0.4. Nothing else changed, just said, well, you guys can pay more. And interestingly enough, that Chapter 70 money dropped off almost proportionately. Almost proportionately. So we're not naive to it. On the contrary, we've been stung a bunch of times. It'd be interesting to look at a business model to see what elementary school or Frontier would look like if it was absolutely minimum contribution done. What would that look like? Just as a tabletop exam. And I say, oh, I know, right? To say we're not spending enough on the students, and then you just look at the minimum contribution that's required, what would that look like? It would look really harsh, but apparently we don't spend enough. And this isn't directed at you guys at all. On the contrary, it's directed at the system. The system's messed up.
See, now Scott.
I'm going to get my John Adams behind.
Right now, we have the...
Well, that's my point.
Well, I understand that. But I think it's also important to bear in mind, we're not naive to those pressures. And the pressures are equally great on our end.
Yeah. One question?
Just it seems like we're all in agreement that at some point to match what we take in with mm-hmm. what we spend, there's going to have
simple
to
math. Variety. An engineer right. speaking.
Exactly. Right. So the question is, strategically, when do we do it, and how much is it?
We're going to have to decide before April 3rd.
Yep. We'll be here next week talking about it. Right. Come on, come back.
I appreciate everybody letting me spout off. It was kind of good.
Feel better?
I feel almost better. Wait till I get home. My right, wife's at home right now. Going, he's going to be mad.
I do understand.
Yeah.
I do understand.
The numbers part is the easiest part of it all.
Well, it's an active committee to take the middle of the budget. So. How would that work out? Budget.
Thanks, Ben.
All right,
Ben.
Thanks,
Ben.
Come on up.
Thanks, Ben.
Thanks, guys.
How are you, Gary? Tanned, rested, and ready, Gary. You look good.
Rested and ready.
Yeah,
I'm good, yawning.
How are you? I don't know, but I'm feeling good.
Gary, what are you running? Okay. All right. You guys got 15 minutes.
And I think we can do it.
Everybody else, I want to say
I have to work harder on this agenda because I look in here, you get 15 minutes for discussion about an override.
I used to do a good job at that.
I squeezed it in last minute, that's why.
Carlos, are you... what happened to Carlos?
I'm here.
Okay. We're going to need you to go fairly quickly because we've got 15 minutes. Thank you. For your work to make Sunderland great again.
We forgot our hats for this.
Everyone gets a red hat. It is truly amazing between a fire truck
yeah,
and a school.
Yeah.
No health care today. We're here to really try to touch base with you on a couple of things that we've been working on. And all of it sort of focuses down in this corner of town. As you know, the Pathways Committee has been involved in a pretty broad range of things that help to make our community more walkable, encourage healthy transportation, and encourage access to a number of the really wonderful assets that we have. And one of the assets that we began to focus on really pretty early in our tenure here was the river, which is just such a special resource that we have here in town. And as you know, we've been working with the Division of Fisheries and Wildlife. We're in fact meeting with them in April to get an update on their plans to redo the boat launch to make that more accessible and eliminate some of the erosion problems there. So we think that's going to be great. They tell us they're going to be able to perform that work next fall, so it'll be ready for the tricentennial, which will be wonderful. And in the process of looking at that, creating a little bit of a pathway along the river between the ball fields and the river, we identified both some opportunities and some recognition that there is some state monies available that we could pursue through a park grant. But in order to do that, we really needed to have a broader master plan. So we've been in the process working with Carlos of putting together a bit of a master plan that looks at essentially this entire space, the ball fields, the access to the river, the boat launch. And we wanted to share that with you today with to get your insights about it. It is not a cheap plan, but we are not here asking for that money this year. There's really a couple of things coming up in the near future that we would hope to be able to gain some political support and ideally down the road some funding support. And that's that one, we've got a park grant application that we can go after this year for a maximum of, I think, $266,000. Matched with some CPA funds to be able to get a phase one. We're not going to tell you what phase one is right now because there's a process that, public process that we would want to go through and try to determine that. But we wanted to share with you tonight the broader vision, get your insights on that, and then move forward. Yeah. So with that, we have been extremely fortunate to be able to secure Carlos and Berkshire Design to help us identify a number of thoughts. Part of this whole process was initiated when we did a public forum a year or so ago. While you may recall that, I think some of you were involved with it. That really got us thinking not only about the boat launch and the river access, but how that interplayed relative to parking, relative to other activities taking place here. And it really helped us to move in the direction of thinking about what do we want this entire parcel to look like, or what might this entire parcel look like down the road. So with that, Carlos, if you'll walk folks through our thoughts here.
Yeah, I think, you know, the first thing that I wanted to put in here is just an existing condition so you can see what we have out here. And one of the main things when the folks from the Ways Committee asked me to come in and look at the park, in addition to looking at this river walk, just looking at this whole master plan, was you have this whole parcel and you're kind of, there's a lot of kind of space that's being kind of unused and it's not being efficiently used. And then the other thing that I looked at immediately as we looked at this was that the orientation of your ball fields is not the most ideal orientation for ball fields. And then I started thinking of, you know, well, there was tennis courts here and things changed around the, basically a lot of things kind of changed around the park, but the park never changed. It kind of stayed in the same place. So that's why when you come in through this parking lot, all of a sudden you have a fence right in front of you and there's kind of no easy way to kind of get into the park. There's no like, gateway that is easy to think of the park as being part of this parking lot and the rest of the library and the town office. So moving from this, we are looking to what could happen in this space. Better orientation of ball fields, also through some contact with the Park and Rec Committee, seeing what their needs are and what they're looking for. And so we came up with this master plan. We looked at several different options of different amounts of fields and amounts of, you know, baseball to soccer and everything else, or multi-use fields that we call these. But I think this is where, you know, where we're at with this kind of process. So I think I'm going to take you from kind of the road into the park. And one of the first things that the park had was that there was no clear way of kind of seeing this is where the park is. And I think some of the ways that we are trying to solve this is providing a separate entrance basically for the park. And this used to be an entrance before, as I've been told and anecdotally. So providing a one-way entrance actually to this part of the park, which actually is directly in relationship to those ball fields. with that also kind of alleviating the parking issue or parking needs that we have from the library. So every time there is a game or anything going on, this will pack, pretty much pack up. And there will be conflicts of use. You know, you have the library people and you have the people who are going to the park. So what we're doing is, seeing here is actually formalizing what now is kind of an overflow parking that happens here, and people actually go through here and then they come into the parking lot. We kind of have separated that so that we don't have to have that traffic going through the library. So that was a main thing that we were looking at in that perspective. The other one is utilizing best that space for the ball field that we have here by pushing it back, taking into consideration the topography, but pushing that park back so that, in a way, first of all, visually, it does open the park up, quite a bit, which is very important because people, again, that notion of where are you going when you get here, it was a little bit not clear. And also for utilizing more of the space and then providing more space for these other uses that we're looking at here. And what we're looking at is, this is what we call the convertible Little League field, which is a 57. It's a ball field that the Little League and Carl Ripken leagues can use. So it's kind of a new trend, basically making the ball field a little bit bigger for those kids that are going up in age, so that when they get to a normal ball field, they're not totally surprised by this length of lane that I have to run now and this pitching distance that we have to do. That's what that provides. And then again, having that discussion with what the needs for fields is, we looked at having, right now there is an overlay field, soccer field that goes over a existing ball field, which is not the ideal situation. So what we're doing here is basically separating. So at that point, we would have actually a full soccer field, and then providing space for a U12 or a small soccer field, which is what we have right now here. Again, we're looking at the vision that we could see for many years in the future here. We're not seeing that this is going to be all built all at once, but then seeing there is a group of people who use that Sand Beach volleyball court, and it's so providing still that use, having an outdoor basketball court, I think it's also an active use that could stay in that area. Looking at a playground, a future playground, to alleviate a little bit of the pressures that the playground, the only playground in town, kind of takes, connected to a library, so that it becomes not just a ball field that you go just to play ball, but it becomes also that area between you take your kids to the library, then you can go to the playground and have that connection there. The skeleton of this, or the bones that are holding all this, is this kind of, we have a circulation pattern that connects to this river walk, which is what the original idea of the whole thing. So what we are providing here is basically a walking path all the way throughout the whole park. And we found in many parks that we've built at BDD, the virtual design, is that actually that is the feature that mostly gets used. It's this walking path that people of all ages can use, from the kid who's starting to learn to ride his bike, with a parent that can be around and kind of overseeing what's going on, to the person who wants to do a little bit of exercise and walking, but they're not feel comfortable to be on the road or being jogging. All these things happen much more in a park once you have that kind of overall circulation that goes all the way around. Other things that we looked at or that I designed in is, an improved bathroom concession storage area. At this point, bathrooms are not in the best shape. The storage area is not in the best shape, and looking into that. Also, the design, the way that it is, it provides this whole area as to be the activity, open space activity area for when we have, fall festival and that sort of thing. So it still provides that kind of infrastructure for the town. And the other thing is, by having kind of like a centralized bathroom concession area or open, with a part of it being open, like a shelter type of thing where you have some picnic tables and everything. I've also provided, you know, we've left this space here where you could have a stage, and then you can see how that then connects directly to the soccer fields. You know, and taking into consideration that parking, we also have some overflow parking so that we can get to a number that really meets the needs of what the park is. You know, right now I think the needs for the parking lot are not, we don't have enough parking for the needs that we have. I mean, I think I've touched as much as possible. I think one of the things that we looked at so that you understand the design process is that if you look at existing conditions, the pieces of the park that are existing right now can stay as we face this in. We haven't, the major change would be this ball field, but we could still do all our paths, do part of what we're looking at and keeping a full functioning ball field as we keep moving along. The same thing with this area up here, that if that's not the objective to keep this one, but you want to keep a soccer field open, we still would have that same space for the soccer field. So it gives options to keep some of the items that we have there, and we're not canceling any of the future activities that people are seeing with the existing ball fields there. So it can be phased in.
Carlos, could you speak about the parking in particular? That was one of the things we heard a lot about.
Yeah.
At the panel.
So one of the other ideas that we had when I say we've increased the parking, I'm also showing parking along here. So, you know, we've increased basically about 60 spaces of parking that we didn't have before.
Over and above what they used to use in the field?
The field, because it wasn't formalized, really, I didn't count as existing parking lots, except for the road right after the parking when I was looking at the numbers. Because I knew, you know, I could say easy, well, the next row we could put as many cars as you have right in front of it. But one of the other things that happens in non-formal parking is that people kind of park in anyway, so it's not the most efficient way. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, by providing a paved area with parking lines and then explaining where the overflow is and having a sidewalk and guardrails, all the things that basically tell you got to stop at this point, it organizes better the parking. Also, I mean, again, alleviating the circulation issue, the conflicts with parking between library, trailer parking, and the ball field. It was a lot of use for the same parking lot. One of the other things that because we're increasing this amount of parking, I'm showing adding or taking away part of that island so that you could have more of that trailer parking, which was an issue that happened, you know, was talked about before. Right now we have three, we would add two more to that same area. And again, the idea is that by shifting some of that use over here, then that issue of having people park on the trailer parking when they don't have a trailer, it could be alleviated here.
Okay, just one question, Carlos.
Yes.
Gary, when they do the river boat launch, in that design, are they anticipating places to put trailers? That's not going to
knock down.
Not now,
because there's
so,
really not.
So we're going to have the risk of building something that probably won't be. Well, the opportunity for more trailers is happening, but we're not addressing where to put the trailers when the boats are in play.
Well, as you know, the topography particular spot is really tough. We have the director of the program out looking at it, as well as their chief designer looking at the space. And, you know, just trying to work within, you know, thank goodness we've now purchased or acquired all of the land down there that is required. But just given the terrain restrictions, it's pretty tough to try to create much of a parking lot in there. So that's
going to drive some of this up here.
It's still going to have to be up here, as it was, you know, even when we did the library.
Right.
But that was an issue that came up in the public forum, and we want it. It was one of the things that kept driving us to thinking about this whole space collectively, as opposed to individual little pieces of the puzzle that didn't all fit together.
Right.
And there's also a small little caveat that the boat ramp is for small, you know, because of the quietness of the river.
Yeah. Right.
There's
a
restriction as to what kinds of boats can really go be put in there.
Yeah,
so
that makes sense.
Most of them are going to be roof
raft
type things.
Right. Kayaks and
small craft. I mean, there are going to be some people that, you know, have small fishing boats that, you know, trail with the men, but
for the most part, they kind of visualize it being more of the roof.
This is, you know, this is not going to be the Northfield boat ramp.
Right. No, I just understood.
Right. We don't want that.
And yet at the same time, the public safety importance of this launch was made to us by the folks at the EPOs and Fish and Wildlife that in this reach of the river, this is really the best access point. Sure. And so whether it's rescue, whether it's search folks, it's really important to have this space function well and be able to accommodate the kind of craft that the EPOs would be bringing in. So it all begins to fit together in I think some important ways. And it's, as we said, this is kind of a longer term vision.
Right.
But we also recognize that the existing condition is problematic. We've got, thankfully, a group of dedicated volunteers. I know probably each of you have been among those volunteers there over the generations who take care of the ball fields, take care of the soccer fields, and without those volunteers, you know, I think we'd be in real trouble down here. One of the things that we heard from the folks in recreation and the volunteers who were doing it, it would be wonderful to get to a point where the town was making a bit more of an investment, even in the fields we currently have. But certainly as we begin to pursue state monies for improvements here, we're going to need to be thinking about how do these improvements get maintained so we don't end up with a soccer field that's like running on the parking lot at Target. You know, it is hard, and you know, needs to be mowed more frequently than we currently are able to. And I think there's it is certainly time to rejuvenate those spaces and get them ready for new generations of Sunderland families. And certainly one of the things that we talked about, and I think Sarah was probably the biggest champion, is how do we make this space feel more accessible and attractive not only to young athletes, but in fact to all generations of folks here in town, providing access to the river and places to walk. So it is, I think it's a wonderful vision. We really appreciate the work that Berkshire Design did on it, and Carlos. And I think at this point, we're looking forward to a couple of different things. We're meeting with folks from the ball clubs tomorrow to begin to walk them through. We want to do additional public forum to begin to hear back from folks. What do they think about this plan? I certainly think that the concerns we're going to hear are going to be about maintenance and disruption of ongoing activities there, which we would need to be very sensitive to as we move forward. You know, certainly we've got the challenge ahead of us of how do you pay for this $2 million?
Well, I mean, and this is really, really rough at cost estimating that we started doing with for the whole site. But yeah, I mean, it's a large park,
sure.
And there's a lot of features that we're showing here,
right.
And we've packed it. I mean, literally, we've utilized as much of the space as we can and do it as efficiently as we can. That said, I never permitted a park project that was not just one playground and one item that was just not phased. I mean, all these projects get phased in 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So it is the way that it goes. And I think, you know, the other item, thinking of that maintenance, is that what we are putting in here is not adding to any of the maintenance that is required for what you have here.
Right.
We're not adding.
It's basically the same components.
Basically the same, the items that ask for more maintenance is the fields. You know, basketball courts, sand volleyball courts, minimal maintenance, really. You know, playgrounds, again, minimal maintenance. You replenish some of the wood chips, but there is, you know, mowing,
sure.
fertilizing, all those nice things that we all know that you have to do to lawns. And of course, when you're doing that type of investment of having these types of fields, it's important to be able to maintain.
So the next things that we've got coming up, as I mentioned, we've got a couple of meetings, including just later on this week, and then we'd like to begin to do some public forums to discuss it, which is why we really wanted to introduce it, these ideas to you first. We're hoping to be able to apply for a park grant this summer, and then move forward with some first phase one. As I mentioned, I couldn't tell you right now what that phase one would look like, but we feel that after we've gotten that public input, we'd have a better sense of what people thought were the most important things to do. And we'd be happy to come back and sort of share those developments with you as we go along. But the other thing that I think is important is you know, beginning to think about what investments does the town put into field maintenance, you know, whether it is the existing condition or whether it's looking to the future, because the park grants are not able to fund maintenance.
Right.
They can fund new stuff. So we do need to be thinking about that, whether we're just trying to extend the life of the facilities we have or whether we're moving on to a next generation of park facilities here.
Well, I think it's important that you took a very good holistic approach to the whole thing, rather than, and especially like the playground, because
right.
for those of us who've like rebuilt the other one and everything, you see the use that it gets, and you're thinking about the library use and everything. And I was having a conversation with somebody just recently too, that Sunderland, unlike many towns, does not have a common
right.
or a real center
right.
or anything. So this is our de facto
exactly.
town common and our town center and our gathering place.
Mm-hmm.
So we, you know, you can see how, and I know you sort of touched on it, but I can kind of visualize too as you're walking in the visual enhancement to this is going to be dramatic compared to walking up and seeing, you know,
the
vinyl coated chain link fence, right? Because you get a sweeping vista of that, you know. And it does really change. And it,
yeah.
I mean, this is our center of our town.
Right.
That's a really good point, Dave. It is, you know, it has, and it has the opportunity to do that even more. And when you look at some of the other features here between the little memorial garden, the beautiful space behind the library, the library itself, this really does become the town gathering point.
Mm-hmm. Inclusive space, a coherent space.
Right, and we're touching on all. It's kind of like we're doing with complete streets. It's
right.
kind of like taking that step and going up, and not just streets,
right.
but all of the use
yeah.
for the town, and especially if our senior housing project takes off and everything.
Yeah,
you know, it's that much of a more welcoming, walking, multi-use area.
Right.
Yeah.
So, we're eligible for it's 260, and we have a pretty good high standing to get those 260 or 256. We have to come up with a match, which we can request from CPA for 136. However, CPA also will not pay for maintenance, and
right.
we're with either of those grants, we have to show that we're going to be
sure.
cover the maintenance, and we would love to see a line added to the budget. We're obviously not going to be needed next year, but to start for the town to start a line in the annual budget for maintenance we'll be able to demonstrate that we have the means to maintain, and it's kind of like the town antes up that, you know, we can't get any of
it's
these
like a
other
good
state
without
funds.
It's a show of good faith.
Exactly, and we without that, we can't even apply for these things.
Well, that dollar value will be developed once we know what the scope of the services is.
Yeah,
that's pretty easy. I mean,
the rec department put together a budget a couple of years ago, an annual maintenance
yep.
budget. And Sherry, do you have this? It was, yes, $6,000.
Okay. If you take that and factor in any increase, and that's something we've been talking about, was the mowing issues. I've heard a number of complaints about that
right. And
discussions.
Right.
Rock?
Scott, you and Dan and I are on this capital improvement
committee.
And you know how that works now, where every year the town appropriates money into the fund.
Correct.
And then the town votes money out of the fund.
Correct.
Is there a chance that the town could set up a maintenance fund where money was put into it every year, 10, 15, 20, whatever it was, 1,000, and then that was used to deal with all of these CPA projects?
Sure.
Comes up every single time.
Sure.
And then that would be solved once and for all. Every time you went in for a CPA, then you'd be able to say, well, we got this funding, and it would be terrific. When we apply for grants also, because we'd have a mechanism where all these various things at least have this funding, like the capital improvements one.
Right. No, you raise a good point about a consistent mechanism. So not stuck with some of the other trappings. Right. It's something we can certainly explore at one of our meetings.
And could we have the old fire truck to
to water the grass, maybe?
Totally.
Be a great part of the playground.
That's right. It would be the most used part.
Kids would love that.
Especially if the lights were still active.
Yeah. Yeah. On Big Truck Day, it would be awesome.
Exactly.
I don't ever remember there being a road on the east side of this building.
I was told that there was, but they might not.
I.
What was there?
Well, we've got the space for
that way. I mean, there's an apron over there.
You didn't
know that apron is for fire protection.
Okay, because we used to, for the fall festivals when we had them where the library is, we used to come up there. We used to come up that side and park over there. So what did we drive up on?
The apron around the school was put there for the fire protection, mm-hmm. So they could put a ladder and get to the second story.
You'd still be able to do that in the new plan.
You have room there for
still be able to do that in the new plan.
It would be tight for survey,
so it's a one way. It's in and then come out the other side.
Yeah, it would look too much like. You know, like a big highway
tank. Well, yeah, there's some limits. You know, you have the memorial right there, which has grading. So there is some limit in there. And, you know, again, I think also by doing the one way, you are, first of all, just to think of the circulation, you would come in one way. If you find your parking, you can circle in the same spot until you find what you need, and then you can just go around and exit. You wouldn't need to go in and exit and come back in if you needed to. You wouldn't find a spot or any of those. But on the other hand, what it really provides is that you have one entrance and one exit, and that is much safer than having two-way traffic in a very small area where you have also a crosswalk because you have the sidewalk going through there.
So we appreciate the opportunity to be able to, during what is a really busy time for you guys, to update you on this, share this. You know, most immediate thing I think is dealing with that maintenance fund, whether it's for the existing fields or the future. And then we'll keep you up to speed as we move towards ideally a summer application for some money for some phase one. And keep you informed as to what that first phase might look like, and we would love your insights and input to that as well.
And I've been working with Sherry. We've got an article on the warrant because the way the park grant works, you have to pre-authorize the funds and then you get reimbursed for them. So we're holding a...
Are we putting that on? Okay.
Yeah.
I need more information then.
There's some blanks. Yeah, there's a couple little,
So a warrant article for the 266?
Well, it's the way we have to do it is that to authorize...
A whole amount, because it's a reimbursable...
$400,000. Yeah. And we have to figure out how the logistics of getting the matching funds and how all the time works. It's a little puzzle that we have.
We're still working on.
It's a Ouija board.
Right.
All right.
I have a call into Melissa, so.
Okay.
I got the easy part. I designed it.
Yeah. I have to say, Carlos, it's a beautiful design. It's very nice.
Yeah.
Thank you so
thank
much.
You.
Right, thanks so much.
Hey, sorry not telling you we're on mountain time now. Right on time.
Right. By the end, we'll be on LA time.
So,
we got the option of having some of this. I would prefer
to do this next.
To have, well, also for maintenance purposes.
Yeah.
They're waiting for it.
But
basically, if you were doing the gravel for the same amount,
I know.
Still
all right.
Probably for half.
Minutes of 3:20.
I'd be happy to vote in the minutes I wasn't here on. Right. Motion to approve the minutes.
Second.
That motion made and seconded on the minutes of 3:20. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Selectman updates. Want to skip those tonight, Scott?
Yeah, if we could. Just briefly, there's a police meeting on Thursday and a capital meeting last week, another capital meeting on Tuesday. So.
Vote additional levy capital stabilization.
I think we should do that.
It's a pretty straightforward thing, isn't it?
Yes, it is. And there's a memo here with the actual value. And there was at 107. Where are you? I saw you.
Here you go, Tony.
Move to assess an additional $107,689 in real estate and personal property taxes for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2017, for the purpose of funding the Capital Stabilization Fund to be expanded for to be expended for municipal capital purposes included in Mass General Law Chapter 44, Section 57 and 58.
Second.
So basically, we voted a few years ago $100,000 capital stabilization that we're able to increase by 2.5%. The first year has to be voted on by town meeting,
right,
which we did do. Subsequent years are allowed to by the board to increase. So we're just increasing that $100,000 by that 2.5% that we're allowed to.
And again, this is directly to capital stabilization.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
We'll do the draft articles in a second. Capital plan, personal advisory recommendations.
If I could, Mr. Chair, the capital plan with respect to review for tonight, if we could take it home and have homework. The capital improvement committee is meeting again on Tuesday, and we're going to
hold off on that.
We're going to bring a recommendation for our next meeting.
Okay.
I just wanted to have the capital plan that the FERCOG did.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, they.
No, absolutely.
The committee voted to
correct.
Recommend acceptance.
Yep, absolutely right.
The selectmen.
So if I could, very briefly, Mr. Chair, the Sherry, rightly so, reached out and got some great input from the COG on plan and structure for forecasting and expenditures out through 2023, I think. And it's nice to actually see, it's an access database with a series of definitions about what can be spent and what can't be spent. But it's a plan not unlike our housing production plan.
Mm-hmm.
It's dynamic in that it affords the community to have its input on its capital needs and shows where those capital monies can come from and sets policy as to where those capital monies can be spent for future boards once we're all the hell out of here. Anyway, it's good for the town. It's actually good. It looks good at the state level as well, having adopted a policy. And I'd recommend that the board, again, this is partly that the COG can get reimbursed for the grant. This is a community compacts grant as well. I recommend that we accept the policy in its form. And it was out to Joe, is it Martanian?
Markanian.
He was going to make some changes in the way the access database moved across a handful of the years to make them individual years with input. Everything else looked great.
Okay. Do you want to take that next week, Sean?
No, actually, that's a vote of the board today just to accept the plan. We're not voting the budget.
Okay.
This is the COG's work, so they can get paid.
Right. motion? You motioned it, Scott?
Yes, I did.
Second, David?
Yeah, second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0.
Sorry about that. I was thinking capital budget, Sherry.
Okay, personnel advisory committee recommendation, David?
We're just getting a copy. We kind of talked about this the last time around.
Have we got a sheet with the total impact of the recommendations?
That's what, yeah. Buried in a raft of paper. Thank you.
Does Scott, I think, Scott, you can have one in the book in the last week's materials.
In the binder budget.
No, it's in your agenda book, but here you can just pass it.
So the total impact, if we went with everything, is 41,377.54, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that was compromised with the personnel. You need a second.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
Okay. What we sat down was and looked at which positions of ours are below. Well, let me step back first. We wanted to kind of get forth as a policy and a philosophy of the personnel committee of having our folks around the middle of the pack in terms of keeping up with the median of our peer groups. So we looked at the positions that we needed to bring up to that level and then figured that out and came up with an amount that it would cost to do that. And then we also used our standard COLA formula, and that came up with a 2% COLA recommendation this year. So the total, if we were to do everything at once, would be $41,377.54, and that's the adjustment plus the COLA.
Right.
And then the COLA for the people who aren't being adjusted.
So where is it? Is the back of the sheet where the adjustments are called out? I see the COLA sheet. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 positions total.
Yep.
And the total of just the shift in the base salaries, shift in the compensation for those puts those positions in the means of our comp towns.
Yep.
Okay. You got some pretty good jumps in there.
We do.
We had $9,000 increase for the highway superintendent, $9,000 increase for the head of youth services, $5,000 increase for the head of young adult services, $2,500 increase. You have a concentration just in the library. I'm not picking on you. Concentration just in the library of $16,000+.
Correct.
Before any raises, before any cost of living.
Right.
Okay. I mean, that's how below the average we are, you know? And that, this isn't
I get it.
A far-ranging thing. This is local.
Understood.
Where are our comp towns? Let's see, hold on.
Sunderland was one of our comp towns. by this list, Sunderland,
Deerfield, Conway, Whately, Brimfield, Granby, Hadley, Hartwick, Hatfield, Northfield, Sheffield, Williamsburg.
Thank you.
The same ones that you've been using, basically.
Right. Okay. And one of the discussions on the personnel committee that we had too was do we, on occasion, need to revisit those comp towns to make sure that we're looking at the right comp towns too? So. And one of the things we're going to try to look at, I think, next year is trying to get the Collins Center to help us out with some of this. Because what we've done over the past several years is we've gotten on a programmatic approach to dealing with the COLAs. And I'd like to see us on a programmatic approach to dealing with keeping up and reviewing salaries in that respect, too, so that we don't end up in a case. And this is compounded by the same thing that we happened with the schools, that 2010 and everything, is we don't want to keep dropping way back, and then you have to make these big leaps to bring yourself and catch up. We want to try to smooth out the process as much as we can. So, but that's one of the things that we know we'd have to deal with is, you know, you look at any given position, and some of these are going to be a big bump.
So when I look at it, so you're only recommending out of the entire town, highway superintendent and laborer, and then all the others are librarians?
Yeah. What we did was we went through and we looked at all the positions that.
So I guess my question is, how can the library be so off on their salaries? I mean, you guys just hired a director a year and a half ago. How can that position be underfunded already?
It was probably underfunded when we started.
We're also talking about the majority of the staff who would be receiving raises have been here for 15 years. So they were hired at, you know, they've been receiving tiny
COLAs,
increases,
right,
but it
right.
has not gone up with inflation.
That's kind of one of the penalties sometimes when you stay at a place for a long time, you don't.
That's why we hired a director a year and a half ago, was because we didn't have enough money in the budget to pay the director that left us to go to Lilly, and then we hired another director 2 years before that and went to Belchertown because they're.
That's going to happen.
We're doing everything we can to keep Catherine believing in us, and so we
just don't want that to happen. Well, I would say when Sharon Cherry left for Greenfield, it was more money, but there was other things involved with that when they left also. And I would say there had to be, because she left from Greenfield and she went to Amherst. So there was a challenge of a bigger library, bigger position, bigger circulation, bigger collection, whatever.
And that's why Greenfield and Amherst are not on our list of comps.
What's that?
That's why Greenfield and Amherst are not on our list of comps. I think that what the personnel committee is trying to do is to keep us even with comparable towns.
With our comp towns, yeah.
So I don't, you know, honestly, I don't think that we can protect ourselves against people who want to go to a bigger town for a bigger challenge, but we should at least be offering a fair salary for the job that people are doing here.
Well, and one of the things that we also have to consider, too, is then we've got contracted positions, which also are below, but those we figured we'd address at contract renewal time. Because we sat down, we wanted to try and get a look at all the positions we needed to look at.
And I will say, you know, also, we came in with a proposal that personnel committee has exceeded. So we were, you know, and I think that's great, because I think you're really trying to take a fair path. So don't yell at us. That's what I'm saying.
So a question about library director wages. The proposal in front of us from the personnel committee has wages at 2.5, increase with 2. So am I looking at this 48,029 that's on this sheet, David? And then the increase with 2.5 is a total of 48,989, right? That's what I'm seeing on the recommendation. Personnel committee. I look at the budget sheet, and it's budgeted this year for 49,924.
That was the department
yes.
request.
Got it.
The department request was higher than with the personnel.
Got it. Thank you. So it's even after the discussion prior in the evening, and I understand the timing of it all. I truly do. We're talking about an additional $41,000 added to our baseline.
Yep.
Moving forward, and that's a recurring expense. It's all labor. I get it, but that makes our discussion about an override that much more important. It just does.
That was one of the reasons why I wanted to make sure we had everything in early enough too, so that we're looking at all the pieces on the table.
Okay.
What's the town's burden for a $40,000 increase in wages?
The operating? It's basically it's like 10 cents a 100,000.
5 cents on the
check.
Yeah. With all the workers' comp and the employment insurance and all that.
Oh. 300. I have that number here in front of me, John. It looks like a fool with a bunch of papers. That's capital. Sherry gave it to me earlier. Anyway, we pay about $151,773
on... I just wondered if it was a percentage number you guys... I have one that I use.
Yeah, it's a little different because we have a couple of different... Well, we have different pools. So if I was going to look at benefits and insurance in total, you know, our benefits and insurance right here are about 721 out of 7 million. And actually, that's not really true. That's not even the operating budget. If 721 out of 6.9 million. So 11%.
Memory, too. Of all the, like these library positions, which ones are getting benefits out of
only
all
two? So library director and head of these services receives part-time benefits. She's at 25 hours a week. No one else receives benefits.
Well, I can certainly support the 2% COLA. I have no issue with that at all. And I know we've done, and this is just me speaking, I know we've done some adjustments in the past. I have to say, it seems that we have done a fair amount of adjustments. It seems, at least in recent history, some of those adjustments have been consolidation of definition of work at the library. And there's been some of those adjustments made in prior years. I get it. I understand.
So, I'm just looking, you're looking at some places of 44% increase?
If you look at individual positions, certain ones.
Yeah, that's what you've got to look at individual positions.
There are
positions.
Some.
Yep.
Now, Bob Doobie's probably the most accomplished individual I know. Did you ever get a 44% increase in your salary?
My lifetime.
how do you justify to the town a 44% increase, Dave?
It depends on, I think, which
five.
If you look at, it depends on how you want to make the argument.
Okay.
I think if you want to look and say strictly in the, and I understand where you're going. I'm just trying to look at all the sides of it. If you look at just based on, oh, position A is getting a 44% increase, then it does sound kind of crazy in that sense. But then you have to look at the goal of what we were trying to achieve here. And then what we needed, as the personnel committee, what we needed to do was to state a policy and to show what it would take to bring us there. So then, like any other thing in the budget, like the school override or anything, then it's up to the all of us in the town as a whole to decide whether or not we support funding X, Y, or Z at a specific level. there are a number of arguments to make, like you said, you know, because, well, why was position A funded at what it was? And those are all valid arguments at that time when you made that hire. Why didn't you say at that time, well, okay, this position is lower than all the others. We should have came in at whatever the level is. And those are all different things that we discussed.
Well, sometimes position also is you look at a position and if you look at I don't know if you looked at hourly rate or total comp. But
we looked at hourly rate, but we also kept in mind total comp because we're not in any danger of overtaking any of our peers in terms of like medical coverage and things like that. So that was one of the things that we did consider.
Yeah, Laura.
I'd just like to say in that particular position with that is probably the hardest position to categorize.
I was looking at the highway superintendent.
I'm sorry, not that one.
I was looking at a different one. Okay. Go ahead.
The one of ours that has probably the biggest jump is probably, you know, I think we would admit it's the hardest one to categorize across the categories. But
yeah, I think the way you look at it is, you justify it is that they're 44% behind what people doing comparable jobs are making, and this is not 44% behind Boston. This is 44% behind Hatfield. And this is someone who's been working for our town for 15 years.
Okay.
So, I guess it's a, I guess for me it's a fundamental question of how positions are created and what their expectations are for. Because if we create a position and we're woefully underfunding it or underpaying it, then should that position have been even created at all? Philosophically. David, should that position, because it appears that we can't afford that position, so should we have the position? Or would it be better to come back with a rate that's more appropriate, you know, a more appropriate rate to begin with? You know, because and I guess that's the hard part, if you bring a position on and you can't afford it, then you're doing disservice, is a disservice done all around.
At the onset.
On the onset, right. Interesting. Because the old calculator is going to work out today.
If you turn it sideways, the numbers get bigger.
They do.
I have one.
I know.
I have one. All right, so David, what do you want to do with this tonight?
Do we need to vote on?
No, it would directly affect the different bits of pieces in the budget. There's no doubt about that. And the question, it seems to me, Mr. Chair, if I could, twofold. One, the position, the recommendation is presented as an either or, right? It's asking for a 2% COLA and a revisiting of the salaries of a handful of positions. Am I getting the memo correctly?
It is, yep.
Okay. So is there any reason that we wouldn't, and this is my inner contract negotiation guy, is there any reason we wouldn't take the 2% COLA and apply it to people who do not have this significant change in their position? There's not anybody in here who is not getting a healthy bump in this reclassification. I know it's pennies, but you know what? In 10 years, it's still more than pennies. Right, so if you did the 2%, you tally it all the way down to 2%, it's only a couple $1,000s, maybe it's four and change on the 2%, but that's not much compared to a $9,000 increase.
Yeah, I think the total 2% is five, is that right, the 5,965?
The total for all positions, right, including the right ones on the front page for the adjustments and the others, is 9,808.
That's what I thought originally.
Right. 73 for just a COLA. That's this.
I don't remember
the last time. I personally think it'd be very hard. You look at the highway superintendent of increasing the salary by $9,200 of 1 year. That almost, I find it hard to do. I did you talk about doing it over a couple, 2-3 years?
We did. Yep.
And
it's also an option. We wanted to look at address. You wanted to kind of take it initially and say, see if we can do the whole thing, and then if not, then we have options of doing other things. Because we did discuss other options, too.
So you take the highway superintendent's total comp with his overtime also?
No.
Overtime's hard to predict.
Yeah, we didn't.
His overtime's hard to predict. That's snow.
Yeah, but when you look at numbers, other people get paid overtime?
Some do, yes.
Some do, but do they all get paid?
Yeah.
Some are just salary.
Right.
So you really don't have a true, so it's hard to say, well, he's that much. I guess that's my point. You know, and that's my problem with the survey is because everybody doesn't compensate people at the same level. Our highway superintendent gets paid for working snowstorms. Some don't.
Right.
We have a working highway superintendent. Some people have a salary.
Just a superintendent.
A superintendent that sits in the office and it starts snowing, he may go sleep, but ours keep working. And we're lucky to have someone like George. Does that make sense, Scott?
No, you can be assured if you were to extrapolate this to its full extent, it wouldn't just be overtime wages. You'd have a significant increase in snow and ice.
Right.
In wages. You're talking about nearly $5 an hour increase.
Right.
For someone who was snow and ice isn't always Monday through Friday, and I'm sounding frankly tired, but anyway, it's not Monday through Friday, 7 to 3.
Absolutely. No, I agree.
So the youth services, can I circle back to the library for holding my chin? The youth services, a $9,000 increase. I understand the comp towns. Lauren, you were saying that's a hard position to kind of...
That's not the one that's actually as hard as the...
Young adult.
Oh, the young adult.
So
okay.
There is no comparable young adult position
okay.
in the around. So that we put her at the same raise level as head of youth services.
Got it.
That is similar position for at least for us, but we don't have a comparable.
Okay.
We're very privileged to have the only library in the area with a dedicated teen library, and our teams are very lucky for it.
Great, thank you. Well, people are going to be passionate about advocating for their positions, and I understand and appreciate what the personnel committee did. I think, frankly, we need to, if I could ask Sherry over the next couple of days, plug this in totality into the budget so that we can look at it as, you know, budget A and...
All right. How it's going to affect it.
I'd like to keep... this one just the way we see it,
and
right,
then
show me what it looks like with another 40 plus thousand added to it, knowing what's happening with this sheet already. We're starting even with the $40,000 in the rears right now. We're talking about adding $40,000 in additional labor costs.
No.
Okay.
No,
so again,
it would
be helpful, not trying to postpone any kind of decision on it, on the contrary. And frankly, I'd like to, if I could, Mr. Chair, I'd like to not, I would like to not kind of cherry pick the recommendations of the personnel committee. I think the reason they get together and do these things is to bring us advice, and we're supposed to take a hard look at it. I think a hard look means that we should look at it as a yes or a no, or something in the middle. I think the individual lots, looking at individual jobs, that's risky business. You know, a COLA is one thing, the percentage in changes is very different. I'd hate to pick out highway superintendent.
That's why we tried to look at it in whole, as right. much as we could.
Right.
But, and also it's one of the reasons why we want to look at the maximum impact of it and get it out there for discussion mm-hmm. purposes
yep.
too, because knowing that you know we've got the issues with the school and everything too, and from my position, I'm in an odd position having to look at what I think we should do on the personnel committee side, but then I step back in the select board position, and I have to look at how everything affects the entire
sure.
budget, and like we talked about with the school, it would be kind of irresponsible to not look at it and face it full on and say, all right, where
sure.
what kind of impact is it going to have? And then deal with it in the totality of the entire budget fund.
So just as a matter of course, where we're at in the budget process right now, if we tacked on $41,000, we would be bringing forward to the town a operating budget that we could fund for this year, but may have to cut next year.
That's the risk. Yep.
Okay.
Exactly.
Okay. I need to see this spreadsheet all spelled right out, and just the kind of orders of magnitude. And again, I appreciate your advocacy. I really, really do. And I think, personally speaking, this board, again, works its due diligence to make sure that the totality of the town is taken care of to the best of our own abilities. So
I would just like to say what I think we said last year is that, you know, we realize that these numbers may be in flux,
totally.
But it would be very helpful for us to know what the flux is,
right.
When they flux, and if they flux, and also to have some input on where the flux may happen,
sure.
Because among these, among our employees that are impacted, we have people of different years of service, and so if we're not going to get to a standard, we may want to have a little input on how that gets distributed.
Okay.
My personal opinion, I don't see how we increase someone's wages $5 an hour 1 year. And let's go back to one other position.
Please.
I can understand doing over 2 or 3 years. I can understand that. I don't think I would be in business very long if I was handing out wages or increases like that. And I would say that if someone's not being appropriate, have the appropriate salary, it probably didn't happen over 1 year, it happened over many. So try to correct it in 1 year is not probably the right way to do it. So I guess we have to make a decision on this next week.
Mm-hmm.
I'll tell you right now, I couldn't do the whole kit and caboodle.
Right.
That's
you simply may not have the money for it. Plus, there's the optics.
But I can look at it and I can understand if somebody's being woefully under, you know, is woefully under scale. I can understand correctly that maybe, you know, do it over 3 years or something like that. But I just can't do 1 year. I hope that.
And so, I'm just curious. So, what are the next steps here? You guys will make your decision at the next meeting.
Yeah,
is there any time for alternative plans?
Next week, we should be purely on the budget. I would say, right, Scott?
100% on the budget.
So I don't think we'd be scheduling like pathways committee or other things like that.
Town moderators, those
moderator association, and.
In your spreadsheet, do you have our original request, or do you have this, or
I
like,
have,
or do you have
nothing? Yes.
You have our
original request.
The department request is in there.
Yep.
Your total request should be here.
So again, not to pick on the director's wages, but this one here is $49,924. The total library request is $134,588.
That sound right?
Yeah, I think so.
Yep.
Actually,
3/20/17 is mine right here. To the library. Yeah, according to this, it actually goes down. You're taking a pay cut for these people.
What's that?
That's okay.
I know.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah, because.
Yes, that was an intentional ask.
Yep. Understood.
Actually, it's hot. This is higher than what's there, Scott.
Yeah.
The director's it.
For the director.
For the director.
This is part,
yeah,
it's part of the trade-off to make these happen. I think that's noble. I get it.
Well, all right.
John, any given day, we can work for nonprofits, right?
Exactly.
All right. Yeah, we will work with the budget. We'll kind of settle up on the budget next week, I would say.
We have to.
Yep.
Appreciate your patience and participation. I really do.
Thank you.
So I would so just check with Sherry, make sure that
your
numbers are in there.
Okay.
We'll have to be going through those.
I'll confirm by email tomorrow.
All right.
Thank you.
So have a great night. Yeah, we can do the includes pretty quickly on the in most of them.
Do that now?
Yeah.
Sure.
Let's get the includes done.
You have the CPA 1, 2.
Yeah, I see. So I see that, and I don't have that one.
I took it off, but we'll put it back on.
Yeah, I don't have that one as a motion to include.
What do you want to do with these?
So if I could, Mr. Chair, I'd suggest that we take a look at them by article, topically describe what the article is, vote no money articles tonight. They're only voting to include tonight. We can do consent, we can do reports, we can do all of that.
The word at a consent article's at the end?
At the end.
Why is article number one not a consent?
I think we have to hear that as part of the kickoff to town meeting so we can do the budget. That's part of the reporting. It was explained to me that handsome moderator. So if I could move to include article one?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Article one's included. 3-0.
Article two is
money article,
but it's prepaid bill. I'm sorry, prior year's invoices only. Let's hold off on the two. Let's hold off on three. Let's hold off on four, which is the budget. We have to get free cash money article. We'll hold off on five. Capital budget is six. Fire truck is seven, so we'll hold off on that.
This is from the CPA, so we can do Article 8.
Yep, I got Article 8. Move to include Article 8.
Second.
Which is the appropriation of $20,874 for the backyard enhancement to the Southern Library CPA fund. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0. Next one is Article 9, which is $17,583 of CPA for the records preservation.
Mm-hmm.
Motion?
Motion.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Include Article 9. Article 10 is appropriate $49,000 from CPA Community Housing Reserves and $51,000 from undesignated budget repair for a total of $100,000 to fund the development of the Sunderland Affordable Senior Housing. This is Article 10. Motion.
Move to include.
Second.
Why do we have to kick in $100,000? Going to be an outside developer.
That's showing a commitment from the town toward the state. The state very competitive for the grants that we have to go through that we're going to be applying for. And by this $100,000 will show the plus the money that we've ponied up for the purchase
for the property,
of the agreement will show that the town is making a serious commitment towards senior housing.
That you guys should consider that in town meeting floor is make it very, very clear that even though you only had one bid, that the town is still on the hook for some cost here, because I think that a lot of people think that, you know, we're free and clear of that property.
We will be after this, depending on how the RDI arrangement comes back from the lawyers. But
this money, what this money will do, right now we own the property. We own the property. What this $100,000, I would recommend is that we tell RDI that we would apply it, and this is a selectman's decision.
Yep.
We would apply it towards the end of the project.
End of the project. That's exactly.
So we know the project is going to happen.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then we would say then that's when the money would be used, not at the beginning for any conceptual drawing or anything else like that. This would be at the end of the project, so we know the project. I would recommend that I would think that we know the project's going to be a go. So then we'd pony up this $100,000.
The role of the $100,000, your execution, you're exactly right, Mr. Chair, but the role of the $100,000 is part of RDI's applications for a host of grant rounds.
Right.
And financing. So
basically,
and you're absolutely right. We would hold it in reserve until the end.
Shows we've got skin in the game, essentially.
Right.
And
so this project is still contingent upon a whole variety of things.
Oh yeah, there's a timeline. Yeah. There's a timeline of
the
grants.
Not until 2 years from now.
No, it's for real.
But that's what.
I just figured I'm moving in next year.
Yeah. Well, you could, but it'd be in Sophie's house. You could be the caretaker. You could be the caretaker.
In the backyard mowing with your wide brim hat on.
But it's going to take a while. And again, it's because of they have to apply for grants, especially from the state. Now, look at what we said. Like I said the other night at the CPC meeting, the community preservation, is that. They they have to win these grants.
Yep.
It's common at the present time for housing money to be given almost exclusively to low mod. Mm-hmm. But when you look in Franklin County, where in senior housing, there's not a lot of it, and they have to throw out a few bones every once in a while. And because we got the number of units, plus we're in an underserved area for senior housing, there's a good shot that they'll get they're counting on getting the loan. All right, so to include Article 10?
Motion.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Article 11 is the is really
the upcoming appropriation.
Community preservation, where they put all the numbers down on papers yep. to conform with the yep. With the state.
Move to approve Article 11.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Pass over number 12.
13.
13 is the citizen's petition. Move to include.
Citizen's petition. And this is basically asking our Congress members to support a amendment to the Constitution, basically saying that, clarifying that corporations do not have the same rights as people.
That's non-binding, right?
Non-binding.
Move to include as it is presented in a citizen's position, petition.
Second.
All those in favor of inclusion, signify by saying aye on 13.
Aye.
Include 13, 14. See if the town will vote to accept the Mass General Law Chapter 218 that allows us to set our speed limits in town.
Only in densely populated areas. Town-owned roads, I'm sorry, thickly settled or business districts. And this came out of the questions on Silver or yeah. North Silver?
North Plain Road.
North Plain Road. Yeah. North Plain
Road. But it was instituted through the governor's...
Correct.
Streamlining government.
Correct.
Municipal
so this was actually an initiative that came up through the lieutenant governor, yep. through the governor from yep. hearing from a lot of yep. communities how they can do business better. So Article 14 to include.
Move to include.
Second.
All those in favor of inclusion of 14, signify by saying aye.
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 Article 15.
Might as well authorize it. They already spent it. Move to include Article 15.
You have a second?
Second.
All those in favor of inclusion of Article 15? Aye.
Aye.
Yay, yay.
Article 16.
We need to pass over this and have discussion.
Yep. Article 17.
I know what the intent is, but with the hour, we're getting close to...
Yep. Article 17.
It's a planning board zoning bylaw code update only for reorganization.
Yep.
Move to include.
Second.
All those in favor, 17.
Aye.
Aye.
Article 18 through 24 are consent articles. Motion to include.
Move to include.
Second.
All those in favor.
Aye.
Aye.
That was easy.
That's it.
And, well, I don't know. There's a couple of things on it that are going to be pretty interesting. Yeah. You know, every now and then, Bob, we get a short warrant and a long money discussion, right?
Well, you know, look at it this way. People have complained that they've been getting too boring lately. So, you know, this should give them a little fat to chew on.
Okay,
you know?
Resignation of Officer Jose Cabrera.
Yes. It is a long one. You want to read the whole thing?
Okay. Move to accept the resignation as presented.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to accept Jose Herrera, who was a special officer, not a special officer, part-time officer at the Sunderland Police. We wish Jose a future...
All the best.
All the best in future pursuit. Yep. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
3-0. Accept the resignation. Anything else?
Our next meeting will be Monday.
Our next meeting will be Monday. I guess we'll be just talking budget next week.
If I could, Mr. Chair, we have to have a decision about our override for the 3rd.
Yep.
The 3rd of April.
All right, Sherry. Next week will be a budget meeting.
Mm-hmm.
all the fun stuff.
And I'd like to apologize to the Pathway Commission, who kind of didn't give them enough time to get where they needed because of a lot of things that were happening. But I appreciate the fact that they stayed around and they were willing to make their presentation. But it is an interesting presentation. It
sure is.
There's a lot of work that went into it.
You did a good job of presenting it a lot of times.
Well, and again, it's hard sometimes putting everything in place. And I know they've been working hard, and their goal, they got a very interesting goal to try to make the center of our town.
I missed our little minute there, Scott.
I got it right here.
I look forward to that.
It'll be quick. This is an account during the revolution. This thing that we work at today, right?
Yeah.
Some guy named Madison observed, wherever the real power in a government lies, there is the danger of oppression. In our governments, the real power lies in the majority of the community, and the invasion of private rights is chiefly to be apprehended, not from acts of government, contrary to the sense of its constituents, but from the acts in which the government is the mere instrument of the major number of those constituents.
Well, someday we'll have to have a translation.
No.
Interesting point.
That's classic Madison. No majority shall outshine the voice of a minority in the constitutional state. Pretty straightforward.
Yep. Okay. Motion?
Motion.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
9:35. We're out.